Welcome to Chicago. It is late at night, so let us play.
Yeah, I guess. Maybe I'll just kill someone and eat them.
Isn't that diablerie, and isn't that frowned upon by the Camarilla?
You know, they call a lot of things. That's the line you typed it in. Hey, everybody. Thank you for joining us for Windy City Kindred. We're starting a little bit late today if you're watching us live. But otherwise, if you're watching a replay, how would you know? So welcome, and welcome to my cast. Lilith is going to be absent today, so we will just deal with the members of the coterie that we have with us. And welcome, if you haven't been following the story so far, darkness has crept into this tight little group. Oh, things are tense. Secrets are being kept. People are working towards their own ends, sometimes to the detriment of the group. We'll see where that takes us. When we last left our group, it was Sunday night in Chicago, and the Elysium that had been planned at the Succubus Club had to be canceled because Sierra Van Burris had a big stake through her heart, was half burned, and Malenkov had disappeared into the night. What you also found out was that the Gary Coterie was responsible for the damage, anyway, to Sierra and shutting down the succubus meeting, and you are now tasked with finding them and ending their miserable existence on this planet. But you also need to find out who motivated them, who hired them, who this Frank Gogan is. We're going to pick up the story on Tuesday evening when you rouse, but Monday, each of you had sort of a free night to do what you will. Sister, let's begin with you, Sister Vindicta, over at your convent in North Chicago. You've got an issue with DuSable. Mm-hmm. And you've decided that you're going to fill him in on everything that's happened so far. You're going to tell him that Julian absconded with him and manufactured the fake death so that he could hide K. Marshall Ellis.
But I also played it up as an ingenious idea.
As an ingenious, absolutely, because that was what you wanted him to do. And that is what you're trying to sell to DuSable that he wanted Julian to do. DuSable's old school.
I more sell it as better to ask for forgiveness none than permission. And I did show that I was angry when they absconded someone from my haven, and these are people mm-hmm. I trusted. So just kind of showing to say, well, that, hey, yeah, it pissed me off too. But then when we talked about it, they came clean with me. It was actually pretty freaking genius. So I'm not mad anymore. And it worked. It convinced you too. So, you know, I'm trying to.
It's a good pitch. It's a good pitch to him. He isn't happy about having his boon, his reward, his prize out of his sight. So he's going to want to see it. My question now is, how much do you know about what K. Marshall has been working on? You did find out about that trick with the blood, right?
Yeah.
Have you talked with DuSable about that?
No, because I still understand it. And I don't want to give him any false information, false hope, false leads.
We had talked a little bit about how the Tremere were different now than they used to be. Your aversion to the blood bond as a younger Tremere is mainly because you don't do it. You don't have the power in your blood to bond another kindred. You can bond ghouls, you know, humans, and turn them, and that sort of easy stuff. DuSable's an older kindred. He's a canine of some long history. He can still bond other kindred, which is why he's always trying to offer you a taste. He wants to see K. Marshall. He wants to bond him.
out of character wise, do I know about the bond? Did we ever talk about Julian's bond?
That was what I was wondering if you had heard. And if you're going to pass that along to Julian when you talk to him.
I just don't remember. I can't recall.
Oh no. I don't believe it ever came up.
You have been playing that pretty close to the vest.
I'm okay with that. At that point, I'm like, okay, well, it is unlike what they did to me. I probably should ask for permission instead of like just barging into their haven. You understand how that is, I'm sure. Just let me make a phone call, get in touch with him, and I'm sure that whether he wants to or not, you'll get to see him, obviously.
He's going to take you at your word.
That you want to see him?
No, that you're going to get him in to see him. Okay. To see K. Marshall. But he's also going to be a bit relentless about this. You could feel he's agitated.
Which is weird.
He feels like there's things going on around me that plots and schemes. I do not like this.
And that's why I came clean with you, because there is other things going on within the city that I don't need you angry at me and breathing down my neck.
Indeed. Disable will take that for now. You can expect probably another call tomorrow. But here you are, Monday evening. You know Disable's concerns. You kind of know Disable's intentions as well. It's probably time that you talk with Julian about it. Do you want to call him or wait until you run into him later?
I'd rather be a face-to-face conversation.
Then we shall leave that for now. Is there anything else you wanted to accomplish on your night off?
No. I mean, I just want to make sure that Disable was taken care of on that issue, and then just prep myself to deal with what I would assume would be the drama between Julian and Lilith and try to figure that out.
Yes, Lilith isn't here, but you do know some things that have been happening between Julian. You know that Julian's upset with her. You heard that very tense conversation from last night. That would be Sunday night to you. You heard that... he took the wheels off her car and left it on blocks.
I thought he just took the whole car.
No, he took just the wheels.
Okay.
I guess if you take the whole car, it doesn't seem nearly as petty.
Yeah.
No.
Sorry. Didn't know you were listening.
No. You hear a voice.
So that will conclude Sister Vindicta's Monday night. You can take care of things at the convent. Make sure you get your herd in order. Maybe recruit somebody new to fill in that empty room at the end of the hall. And let's go over and talk to Julian. Similar situation for you on Monday night. You've had that very tense conversation with Lilith. Been tasked with finding this Gary Coterie. You're surrounded by incompetence. What are your plans?
First things first, when I find out that Lilith has addressed her need, I go, good. Hopefully now she feels like she's in control.
Yes, your men will come back to you. I imagine a crew of three smartly dressed people who work with the speed of NASCAR efficiency in removing the tires off of her car. But by the next day, you'll find that another crew of equally speedy people went in and jacked her car back up and put on some big ass 22 white walls with spinning rims.
So she does have resources. How interesting. And
this car is gaudy as all hell now. And I mean gaudy. It even sits up about 6 inches higher than it used to because the 22s don't fit in the wheel well right. Yeah. Her speedometer is all kinds of fucked up because it doesn't get the right revolutions per turn. It always looks like she's going 20 miles an hour slower than she is.
Question. Is this consistent with my understanding of... what is she?
Clan-wise? She's a Toreador.
Yes. Is this consistent?
Oh, not at all. Not even a little.
Okay.
A Toreador in your mind wouldn't be caught alive in that car.
Nice.
Yeah, okay. I'm gonna put that to the side for a second, but I will say to Narvin, how did she do that? How interesting. I thought that she was just somebody down on her luck who thought I was pitying her. So interesting.
He doesn't have an immediate answer, but he can look into it if that's what you're asking.
I don't know if I'm asking that yet. I'll say that. I don't know if I'm asking that yet. I don't know if I really care. Let's move on. I don't know if I'm asking that yet. I'll say
Narvin had also given you a report about the what he found out about that ammunition.
Let's move on.
Yes.
I don't know if I'm asking
that yet. Narvin had also given you a report
about... My question to you, storyteller-wise...
Do what I can.
Is this information that people would want to know?
Which people? Pushing it up the chain or?
Fiorenza.
That's.
Or.
I'm sure Fiorenza would find it interesting, though probably of not an immediate concern to her. The sheriff and the prince would find it of immediate concern to them. And you don't really.
So you said that Fiorenza can smooth over ruffled Ventru?
If that's what you need her to do.
Yeah,
do the big things, remember?
Yeah, that's what I would like to do.
Do you want her to?
Think I would ask her advice.
Okay.
I think I would ask her for her advice and assistance in handling this threat to the Ventru Chicago. I mean, that's what it really is. It's an attack. Or it's an enemy right outside the gates.
Enemy at the gates is probably the most appropriate way to describe it. If Black Site 24 rumors are to be believed, it's only 130 miles from Chicago. It's a short drive. And if the rest of the rumors are to be believed, it's where captive kindred are taken.
And do I have any information in the laptop to impress upon whoever I'm talking to how they're working with Flyboy and how dangerous that connection is?
Flyboy has covered his tracks. All the information that you got off of the laptop is what you have, but his emails have gone dead. His communications have gone silent. You can't jack into anything that he was previously communicating with. Nothing in the laptop goes directly back to Chalmute Air Force Base or Black Site 24 or First Light. The only person it goes back to is a guy by the name of Daniel Bailey.
Okay.
And Daniel Bailey is a name. That's all you really have. You don't have an image of him. You don't have an idea of what he does or where he works, that kind of thing.
Okay, then I will ask Fiorenza for help in connecting the two or finding out more information about it so that I can present it eventually. But I'm not going to present it right now.
If you tell Fiorenza about specifically the ammunition, because that's it's a unique ammunition, having a gangrel claw tip on the bullet. Mm-hmm. Gangrel don't usually give them up willingly.
Do they grow back?
They do, but they don't give them up willingly.
Okay. So whatever she suggests I do, I will take that into strong advisement.
She can back channel some corporate things and give you an idea of what Blacksite 24 really is. She can give you some names of potential, I want to say workers, but people who can be compromised who are on the inside there. And you can potentially run into. This will take a little bit of time.
Okay.
And she will do this for you. But my dear, I shall ask you for a favor.
Isn't that what friends are for?
Ah, I love to hear you talk in that way. Ciao, Bella. And she'll hang up, but she'll get back in touch with you soon.
Okay.
If she could put together a reasonable flow chart for how this is all happening in the Chicago area, then she may be able to get you to deliver it to the prince and have him listen to you about it. But let her do her work and, you know, put these things together. She doesn't want to go to the prince with half of an idea.
Right.
You know, this has to be, like you said, solid information and actionable intelligence.
And the last thing, I will finish the sale that I started, the transaction that I started to look into.
Yes, you have some contacts out there who are scouring some of the deep web and stuff. What you found is your contact is going to show you a picture of the item that you can potentially buy. It's a German silver cross medal that has a 30-06 round embedded in it. It's a World War II trinket. Looks like it came off of a German soldier, an officer. And it certainly has a story to tell with the bullet fused to the metal. We won't talk the specific price, but it'll just simply be a resource that you're spending. And this will come into your possession in the next night or two, if it's something you're interested in.
Cool.
Anything else then on Julian's side?
Nope.
Then it's just back to work for you, to your office, and making sure that the show coming up for this week has a good guest list. You can do your thinking and your feeding and your scheming all to yourself. And we'll switch over and talk to Arthur.
Bonsoir.
Bonsoir, Arthur. Oh, Sunday was a hell of a day for you. Tough day.
Very personal.
I see you taking it that way. You were invaded. Your privacy, your property. You've suffered losses. Good men too. They were, one is still in the hospital. He'll recover. But two of them are down permanently. You've decided to use the proceeds from your most recent sale to help those families?
Oui. Since they were the best at being bad, they should be properly cared for.
Then through your contact, you've put out for sale a German silver cross intersected with a bullet that's kind of been fused into it. You have an interested party, and they're going to make the deal. Obviously, you're keeping yourself out of this, mm-hmm. and the buyer is probably keeping himself out of it as well.
And Arthur, through his intermediaries, will try haggling. If there's a silver cross, there was a bronze that superseded it. There is the gold, silver, bronze, all part of three. Altogether, significantly more expensive, but they have you have the whole story to tell. Alternatively, there was also a matched set of Mauser C96 with the broomstock handle and a holster with matching serial numbers. I'll even throw in an unfired stripper clip. It's significantly more expensive since the firearms typically go up on auction, but for a hefty sum, I can just cut out the middleman.
Interesting. Well, looks like you're getting rid of more than I thought. And we'll check with the buyer's contact and see if they're interested in the rest, but I'll bet he is.
Yeah. And the out of character, the discerning fire specialist would never fire that firearm. Like, oh, that is just flushing money down the toilet.
And that stripper clip of ammo too. You'd never use that either.
Oh yeah, no. See, it goes in a nice wooden frame, and it just
exactly.
Let's say inspired by the recent events, I would like to start going around by usual circuits of browbeaters, boxers, my fighting men. And I'm going to put together a little battle royale competition.
Ah, a little in-house tournament.
Yeah,
talent.
Yeah, I do not have a belt, but bragging rights in certain circles, and also working directly for me.
These boxers, they know what they're fighting for in this place. They want their picture on the wall. That's the prize in this room. The biggest boxers get up. For you is usually lucrative and not usually so deadly, but.
No, it was a fluke. What the chances of it happening again?
Exactly.
It was like, my boys, look on that wall. If you are lucky, that is the beginning of your immortality.
Excellent. We'll set up a little tournament. We'll find you a couple of the top men in the city, or at least in your gym.
Mm-hmm. And it's like if someone who's got the credentials wants to throw their hat in with the big boys in town, they're more than welcome to.
Oh, do you want to open this up to amateur night? I mean,
hey, Rocky Balboa started somewhere, and look where he got.
In fairness, Rocky had a terrible record before Apollo Creed gave him that shot.
He's a trier, and you have to respect that.
But an absolutely terrible record.
Okay.
He's probably got the worst heavyweight record of all the heavyweights, champion.
But the movie feels so good in this heart that no longer beats. Italian stallion. Anyways, if there's other similar underground boxing circuits that have a toe in, this is the similar sanguine waters that the Lion's Den does, we'll say, hey, like send over your contenders.
You know what? Give me do you have a little dot in Streetwise or something, don't you?
It's either Streetwise. I want to say it's Streetwise. I have two in Streetwise.
Then give me a wit Streetwise, and I can maybe tell you something about the city.
Let's have the first roll be a good one tonight. Yeah, it's okay. That's two successes.
Two.
Not a success on the hunger die. So.
But you got two successes on the regular dice.
Yeah, it's a 9 and a 7, a 4 and a 4.
You've heard of a place that does a little underground bare knuckle boxing ring on a regular basis. Not even the gloves. I mean the old school, Clint Eastwood, Philo Beto bare knuckle stuff.
Yeah, they got like tape at best. Yeah.
Tape at best, and that's all there is. The place you heard about this is called Hate Church, but you've got no idea where it is.
Oh, that's so fucking metal. Okay. Oh, man. Hate Church, one or two words?
Hate Church, two words, you think. I think two, but if you can make it look good as one word, it just it tends to mess up the syllabics.
Hate Church, I love it. Okay, all right. They will be sent an invitation through couriers like our tapes do.
Yeah, you may have to put the word out through the street, but I think you can at least send a rumor that would reach them.
Yeah,
I'm confused when nuns show up.
Yeah, it's just like it's true for the nun. I had the dream about this once. he'll pick out the ones with the that definitely have like the most severe cauliflower looking ears that he expects loyalty, but not, you know, exclusivity to his gym. His, you know, his guys are welcome to go out and, you know, cross pollinate, as it was. And he'll tell them, it's like, yeah, the other gyms, like, spread the word, talk some shit. But that is fan freaking tastic. Hey, man, hate church.
You need to find out where that is, I guess.
No, I need to find out where that is. So maybe like I maybe on an off night I can play. but also like business merger, if I'm speaking my friend Julian's language. And there's some of his favorite nomenclature too. All right. I think between the sales, ongoing conversation and all of that. Any word from Rosa about has she been able to suss up anything?
Rosa is piling through that information that she's finally gotten about Flyboy and the laptop. She is trying to find out who Daniel Bailey is on her own. She's also trying to piece together what, if anything, they have to do with First Light or the Second Inquisition or Black Site 24. For all she knows, these could be completely unrelated things. You could be facing a multiple pronged attack. And that's what she's most concerned about, is that Flyboy and this Daniel Bailey are not connected to First Light or Black Site 24. And that means that there would be multiple fronts for a fight they didn't even know they were in the middle of. She's terrified, to be frank.
Yeah, that would not do. Pretty face like that should not be soured by such fear. It would stand to reason that several of my clientele take the L, correct?
This is true.
On those that do and would that stay late for the extracurricular activities of the Lion's Den. I will ask a few of them if they could, on their way home, keep an eye out for a somewhat whimsy-looking fellow who's always said to be on the L at night. Perhaps ask around for one Evan Klein. I would like to know, perchance, if there would be a certain stop, we should be best to have a conversation.
You are very close to the downtown L from where your Lion's Den boxing gym is. In fact, a lot of your men actually take the L. Easy enough to send them out and see if they find somebody of that particular description, and they will probably be back to you by the next night.
All right. Point of order, I am not going to send in the ones that have signed up for the championship tournament. Or at least the ones I'm putting money on.
Okay.
That would be bad. And I think that's everything. This is more out of character point of order for maintaining my inventory notes. It was Sister Vindicta went full nuns and ammo, and she helped herself to one of the SMGs, correct?
Was it an SMG, or did you just grab yourself a handgun?
Arthur grabbed all of the SMGs that he could from the hunters. Yeah,
Ellie grabbed a handgun.
She grabbed the other
ones. Yeah. Okay. And start. I'll keep one of them for myself because, I mean, come on, these are still hard to come by. Others, Arthur will put back into circulation through his movers.
Assuming that the specialized ammo is not going out into circulation.
I'm keeping those.
Yeah, okay. Just making sure.
Yeah, those are mine. And I swear that's everything now. That'll be all that Arthur will be getting up to.
All right. That sounds like a good Monday for Arthur. So with that, I think, Lilith also has a couple of irons in the fire. She will contact the rest of the coterie and say that she may have a lead on the gangrel members of the Gary coterie. Her contact says that the gangrel, at least the two gangrel of that group, are staying at the open cemetery in Chicago. But the word on the street is they arrive in the minutes before dawn. So as not to get, jumped, probably. She does not know where they're at prior to arriving at the cemetery, but there, you know that that's probably where they're going to ground during the day. That, I think, covers it up for everybody. When next time you see Lilith, she'll be driving her red Lexus with these obnoxiously huge 22s, white walls, and spinning rims. I don't know if she's going to hit the horn, but if she does, she'll find something else playing.
I hate it so much, and I love it at the same time. it's trash, the capital T, and it's all in italics. It's great.
In Comic Sans.
You're fighting dirty, okay.
All right, then. So let me take you to the city map and let us begin on Tuesday evening, everyone. Now that we've got that Monday out of the way and all of our little moving and parts are falling into place, the cogs are all spinning together. Oh, it's an exciting time in Chicago. But it is late at night in Chicago. So let us play. Why don't you guys give me a rouse check for the evening as you wake? See how hungry you feel. It's assumed that Monday night you either did not take on any additional hunger or you took care of it to the point where you're the same as you were Sunday night. Okay. Most of everybody fed, so you should just be at one.
That was a failure to rouse for me, so that's...
You rouse, you just
get rouse, hungry. But yeah. Failure to maintain metabolism.
Oh, Julianne. You're feeling a bit hungrier. Sister, you seem fine. So, as the evening begins... Arthur, your men can come back to you and tell you they have an ID on Evan Klein. There's a freaky, skinny guy that rides the downtown loop almost all night long and just stares out the window talking to himself.
Does he move from car to car, or is he staying in one seat the entire
time? Seems like he stays in one seat, just holds court. He'll talk to people that come up to him, but other than that, he doesn't seem to do anything but talk to himself. They will mention he seems crazy.
This is, it makes business more interesting, no? Think for it up, boys. Go have some fun.
If they hadn't been anything other than human, they might have recognized that crazy as actually being Malkavian. But that's what where Evan Klein can be found.
Chance. All right. Yeah, be good. He'll give them the fire spark treatment for a job well done. They can have the run of the place within reason.
You know, basically they just go open up the soda machine and grab a couple of.
This is like, it's your imagination. But then again, someone they hit on the head, they can be.
They're expected. Simple people. They didn't want for much. They just thought a Coke would be good.
And
that's almost more evil than what Julian does. These two kids just wanted some soda pop, and here they are embroiled in.
It's like, bon chance, my friends. I hope to see you again. I will remember you, whoever you are. All right, kid, I have fun. Go enjoy your evening. Off.
And they'll go, giving Napoleon a little pat on the head on the way out. Yeah, Napoleon. Gotta keep Napoleon in the group. Of course. Let's go over to Sister Vindicta. You've woken this evening feeling rather refreshed, not hungry. Any leets not any more hungry than you usually are. What are your plans?
I'm gonna first call and see if Julian's up to receiving visitors, because I speak to him about Dusable.
Then, yes, you should probably give Julian a call.
Yeah, sure.
And one of the things that I should steal from Wes's game is the phone ringing. I like that.
Oh,
That was a good touch. You caught me. I was like, I should take that. So imagine you hear a phone ringing. Sister Vindicta would like to talk to you.
Sister.
Hi, Julian. I just got, I was yesterday. I had a lovely chat with Dusable in person again. And there's a couple of things I'd like to discuss with you for the situation. But I think it'd be better in person than on the phone. Do you have time today?
For you, of course. Please. Do you need a car to come get you, or?
I would appreciate one, yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Send Narvin?
Mm-hmm.
Or just a driver?
Narvin.
Okay.
As a show of respect.
Aw. And also, just in case we get followed.
Narvin does have skills. Meeting over where? Downtown apartment, where it looks like you're at now, Julian, or at the lab?
I guess I know why she's calling. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the lab is fine.
All right. Sister, I see you changing out of your habit.
Changing in the car, yeah.
Callisto is going to be... Calypso, sorry. I'm getting that wrong. I love your new mask identity for being out in public.
Yeah.
She's very nondescript, very quiet. People don't recognize you. It's pretty amazing. Once you get out of the top part of the habit, I don't know, maybe it's just because you have hair now. But even the most devout Catholics, you could run into somebody from your parish and they wouldn't recognize you, unless of course you started talking, at which point they'd be like, that sounds very familiar.
I just rude. I'm rude and I bump into them and bump away.
And they think you're just a native Chicagoan, because that's how they roll. So Narvin will come and pick you up and we'll take you over to Julian's lab that he has set up for K. Marshall Ellis. Arthur, did you have plans to join them? Talk to somebody?
Since Arthur was not clued in on the whole, the French French conflict of interests, he'll go in before rendezvous with the coterie, see if he can speak with Yvonne.
Oh, Evan Klein. And while Narvin is going over to the Sisters Convent to pick her up and bring her back to Julian, let's take you on a little ride on the L.
I'm looking for a skinny kind of they said he was skinny and crazy looking. They didn't give me a hair color or clothing, did they?
They did not. But when you get to the three car loop route, it's an empty subway car. In Chicago, the subway is actually elevated above the street as opposed to below it. So that's why they call it the L, obviously. Downtown has a loop that just rolls through the downtown area. It makes a kind of a big old ellipse just through the financial sector. Most of the train cars are empty. When you get to the very front train car, you'll see this guy. Just sort of staring out a window, talking to himself. And are we on that? Yeah.
Shop dressed men. Okay.
Oh yeah. Arthur. He's got the top hat. He's got the frilliness on his jacket. He does not have the trickle of blood coming down his face, because that would be a little obvious out in public.
He's a milk.
He's crazy.
Okay.
And just babbling to himself, just talking in the window.
Excuse me, monsieur. I hate to interrupt the town hall meeting going on presently, but I was wondering if I could speak with you.
And who are you?
How rude of me. I am Arthur Vallon. I am a representative of our kindred kind in a different capacity.
Oh, you're one of us. I like you. You're one of us. He puts out his hand to shake it. And when you do, his face changes. He literally, his face changes from that of the one you saw into a more shallow, kind of drawn face. Hi. I'm Tommy. How you doing?
I'm doing quite well. You are a clever one. Tommy, you said.
That's right. I'm Tommy. Tommy Holm. Okay. I can help you.
Well, may I take a seat? Or did you prefer I stand?
He'll just invite you to sit down right next to him.
Yeah, he'll sit down. There are things unfolding that have myself, as of course a defender of all good and just kindred in this city, that would involve a small group of us, my coterie specifically, to enter your territory, and I would of course like a Maclavian's blessing before doing anything that could be seen as intrusive.
Oh, this is like an introduction. Like, yeah.
We can call it a tete-a-tete. We can call it negotiations. We can call this a talk between friends. It all depends how it ends.
He's like, you hang on. You need to talk to somebody else. And his face is going to change yet again. He's actually going to get darker. He's going to turn into a black man right in front of you. He's going to sit up a little bit straighter. And he's like, I'm Ray Falcon. Yeah, I hear what you're saying. You need some permission. I get you. All right. Now, you got to understand how this works. Now, we don't all run that. You know, there's just one that's in charge. Not all of us.
And you see strapping, well-spoken men like yourself. I assume that was you.
No, I'm just a simple musician, man. I come out and I play my bass and I go home. That's all I do. I play my jazz, you know?
You play the jazz. Oh, I used to be in New Orleans. I love the jazz. I must hear you play sometime. But pleasantries, perhaps, after business, huh?
His face will change yet again.
Oh, sweet Mother Mercy.
This time he's going back to that first guy that you met with the top hat and the it's like, yeah, all right. I'm Evan Klein. I'm pleased to meet you. And you need some permission to go where? Where do you need to go?
Specifically, there is the hospital that I'm sure Arthur remembers, but I do not.
Brookdale?
Yes. Yeah. Is it Crookdale, you said? Brookdale. Like, Brookdale. Yeah, there's a hospital in Brookdale. And we fear that some people of import might be taken there against their will. Of course, this was all obviously done without your knowing. You are not to blame. We are not here to pour an inquisition against you or any of the Maclevians. We simply want to extradite these poor unfortunate souls, and we wouldn't like to not engage hostilities indirectly with the esteemed clan like yourself.
I think I'm hearing you, but you know, you're talking a lot about, you know, you're whatever. Look, Brookdale isn't my territory. That's Sun's territory. And Sun doesn't like visitors. He doesn't like anybody. And I don't, who are you looking for?
It's just, there's quite a few, and that is sensitive information.
So you're not really giving me a whole lot to work with. His face will change really quickly into red. Yeah, brother, help him out, man. Help him out. We got to speak a little bit more clearly. You know what I'm saying? And his face will change yet again back into the really drawn. Come on, man. Just talk. Just say what you mean. And then back into Evan Klein one more time. So you see what I'm dealing with.
Of course, that must, as I said, it's a town meeting. It must be so important, everything going on there. Very well. Speak plain. We are trying to prevent a calamitous threat from befalling, not just one clan or the other, whether they be Sabbat or they be Camarilla. We are trying to prevent a war against an inquisition of humans and a civil war at the same time.
That sounds pretty big. That sounds really big. Big, man.
And I was told that to speak on such matters, I had to seek out someone as important as yourself.
All right, man.
As all yourselves, pardon me.
I can let you go to the hospital, but I don't know what you're looking for.
There's a person of interest we would hope to secure.
Give me a name, man. Just give me a name. Give me a name.
Just are you familiar with operational security, my friend?
I mean, we're alone, right?
I understand, but I mean, the city has eyes and ears everywhere. Until I know how deeply the rabbit hole proverbially goes, I've trusted you with so much already.
I'll give you a thing. You can whisper it to me. Whisper me a name. Whisper me a name.
Okay. I needed to tap over to my notes.
Whose name do you need?
The one that's at the one that's at the hospital. Where?
Who's, well, nobody's back at the hospital.
Right now, because that's where we're supposed to be taken to be burned.
Right.
There's a few people that might be
operating there. They're, they work for Gary.
Gary who?
As in, they're from Gary. They are a coterie of very, very bad kindred that would seek to tear down everything this whole house of cards we've built in Chicago.
So you're looking for a coterie from Gary.
That have been, whether you've known it or not, or I don't think you have, you're an upstanding man. But there is a high possibility that one in particular, he'll be in whispers, no man, has been using this hospital new territory for kindred disposal, staking them and burning them alive.
Evan's face will change yet again. And what's strange about his obfuscation is that it seems very, very natural. It's not like he's forcing himself to change his face. You've seen other kindred do it. Gangrel are very used to being able to see physical form change, but this one is completely tied to his personalities. Yeah. Every face, every personality has its own unique face.
Yeah, so it's like DID and his disciplines going hand in hand. That's... Oh, okay.
He's a very unique... The other reason that he's unique from a kindred point of view is when you're embraced, when you have your becoming, it typically cures what ails you. If you embrace someone with cancer, their cancer is destroyed as they continue to live their unlife. Even crazy people tend to get their brains fixed when they get embraced. Evan Klein kept his multiple personalities through his embrace, which makes you think that maybe it's not a fault to be corrected. His face is one you haven't seen yet.
Oh, dear.
He sits up very strong. Very tall, very straight, chiseled jaw. Very proud. It's like, what do you want with Snowman?
And he is a suspect. People esteemed kindred, our kind. The true death is no joking matter. I would have him questioned.
And question.
If he is found guilty, he will meet punishment. If he is not, then we will find who has been soiling his name.
What has he done?
Well, I can only speak to what has been done to me. He came into my haven, or rather he sent whelps to come into my haven and try to set me on fire. He also managed to harm one of my guests, a very fine woman who deserved no such thing. I understand this may come across as if it's very personal, but perhaps, as I said, he's being solid. Perhaps he is under the thumb of someone more powerful. I would wish to pursue this meandering little thread of evidence, and it leads me to the hospital.
Indeed, it has led you to me.
Yes, because I would not be so bold as to repeat the purported crimes of Snowman.
Snowman is only doing what I hired him to do.
Is that so?
and his face will change one more time. And Evan Klein will be sitting back in front of you and be like, there you go, man. There you go. You got your answers now. You can go to that hospital.
Of course. Thank you for your time.
I'll let Arthur digest that conversation as he leaves the next stop of the L and maybe heads back to wherever you'd like to go.
So is drone strike an option?
I don't know that you have a drone.
Obviously Julian has, I'm sure he has military contracts.
Oh, sure.
Fucker's got everything. Okay. Getting off to call, you know, no. Fuck the sheriff.
Oh shit, I shouldn't be laughing.
No, it's fine. It's the man. Arthur's going to call Rosa.
As you get off the train and watch it depart, you can call Rosa and she will pick up.
Arthur will wait until he's whole down on the ground floor. So that way fucking all of them, singular them, don't see
that the train's pulling away. He's gonna stay on it. He's not planning on going anywhere.
Is the land secure? Or are you alone?
Say what you need.
Well, I have a thread on Snowman, and it is far more complex than I had ever.
Oh, well, would you like to meet then in person?
This would probably be safer, yes.
If you want her to meet you back at your lion's den, or if you want to meet in a neutral location, that's fine.
Being a gentleman, he'll let the lady pick.
I don't know if I have anything prepared.
I'm sorry.
No, that's okay. I didn't. I'm trying to scroll through my whole list of things. You know what? She'll meet you at a park.
Just classic spycraft.
One of her locations is the Garfield Park Conservatory. If you look on the map, it's just right there at Garfield Park. It's actually marked. If you meet her there, you can talk freely.
Yep. He will make his way there on foot.
You can actually continue to take the train if you really wanted to.
Okay. I swear, if I get attacked by three people that are actually nine, I'm gonna eject. He'll wait for the next trolley to come along, and he'll hop on.
Okay. When you get to Garfield Park Conservatory, it's a very beautiful park. It is a conservatory for foliage, fauna, plants, trees, all kinds. It's an enormous indoor greenhouse featuring plants and exotic species from all over the world. There's even a hedge mage here that they call the Labyrinth. It's cute. Rosa will be waiting for you. What is it that troubles you?
I went to go encounter our friend Evan Klein. It is far more than just one individual, unfortunately.
Is it the first time you have met him?
That was an experience. One that I would hope not to repeat, since according to his final face, who I did not get the name of. But he did, or Snowman did precisely what they hired him to do.
I thought you said he was hired by Frank Gorgon.
And voila, you have his name.
Evan Klein is Frank Gorgon?
Perhaps. Whether that was a name that he adopted, a personality he adopted through his psychosis, or maybe it was always it. I do not know.
That is shocking. He was, I knew Frank Gorgon. He died. But, what did he look like? He was a very, very proper, very good, very handsome, strong, jawed individual.
And you've described him exactly.
No one has ever seen Evan Klein become Frank Gorgon. It's not one of his personalities that we know about. We know about the bass player and the Tommy Holm and all the rest. But I've never known him to be Frank Gorgon. This is new.
This is why I share it with you. You are a gangrel. You are my direct superior. I would rather advance our own kind rather than feed this to someone who doesn't deserve the position and recognition.
I don't know how I can bring this to the prince.
You are a clever woman, far more than I, you'll think.
No, you don't understand. Evan Klein is a child of Sun. His son's child. Sun loved him because he was also crazy, with the multiple personalities, multiple Klein. And then he got permission to embrace him. And we all thought, well, there goes the multiple personality part. But he stayed multiple Klein.
You're saying...
Sun loved that about him. I don't know what this means, but I can't bring it to the council because Sun.
Who else do you trust? On the council or not?
Well, I do trust Khalid. Khalid Anas. He's always been straight thinker, straight forward. Even for Anas, usually sneaky, but he's a good man. He could get the prince's ear.
If you trust him with this information, and perhaps if he can be brought in on, because I hate to surf the stereotypes, we know how the Anas are. Perhaps if he is indeed a patriot, he could help in discovering the source of this mystery.
You keep this quiet.
My mouth to your ears and nowhere else, madam.
This is very dangerous. I will find a way. But you be careful. You be careful now because you know things.
I've had hunters after me. I've had someone try and burn me in my torpor. I'd say, yeah, things are getting more interesting. I live for these.
You're so good.
I find myself when I'm lost in the woods.
All right. I will be in touch.
Very good. Au revoir, madame. There's the classic.
Yes.
Kiss to the ring.
She likes it. She loves the deference. Who doesn't?
Then, sister, by this time, Narvin has picked you up and is taking you back to the lab with Julian.
Yeah.
So let's get you over there.
I just need to calm down from what happened over there. Give me a second.
And is Arthur going to join them? Do you have any interest? Do you know if they're going to be there?
I'll let them have a scene because I need to refill my drink anyway. Because that was lengthy. Yeah, give them their limelight, and when it makes most sense, Arthur will phone in and say, "Hey, you guys want a party?" I'll be right back.
Okay. Then here at the lab, K. Marshall is still going about his thing, coming up with new ideas about the blood and its technology. The phones are coming along. You could see the little housing units he's got for them. The boards aren't done yet, but soon.
So we're now together in the same spot, I'm assuming. Yeah.
Are you?
Are we?
Okay. Yeah. I didn't know if she wanted to look around or talk to him or anything first.
So. I'm just like basically, I'll take it from a bird's eye view, like how the picture is right now. Like we're up on the second area, and just looking down at the people working. See little K. Marshall flitting about, being all energetic.
He's flitting and being energetic and coming up with ideas.
Julian will walk up next to you and look first to make sure that you're who he thinks you are. Sister. That is quite the mask.
Thank you.
Why don't we step into my office, and I'll lead you into an office that obviously doesn't get a whole lot of use. There's like not a whole lot in it.
Looks like it's straight out of GTA 5.
It is straight out of GTA 5, in fact.
We need to share backgrounds so that way we can actually coordinate. We'll
actually spin this office and be like, boom. That nice view of the river there in Chicago. That's good. Good background for you too.
So what can I do for you?
Has Disable been in contact with you at all? Has he been bugging you?
I had a dream that I had a very nasty voicemail. But...
Well played. I like that.
Well played.
Excuse me. So I had to come clean with him with everything that's happening right now. And just, you know, confess that it wasn't my idea, that it was your idea, and that it was a great idea because it fooled him. Although I didn't use the term fooled him because that would have pricked his ego, and we don't want to do that, or at least I don't want to do that. And he's very insistent that he sees K. Marshall Ellis and his setup himself. Unfortunately, I also know what he's after with K. Marshall Ellis, something I'm not very happy with him about, but I wanted to let you know that you're probably going to get badgered by Disable soon.
If he wants Ellis back, he can have him.
I don't think he wants him back. He just wants to see you. That's what I got anyway.
Well, I'm afraid we can't have it both ways.
Oh.
Do you want me to keep him? Does he want me to keep him safe, or does he want him?
It seemed like he was really antsy, and it's like we took away one of his favorite toys, and I don't quite understand why.
Well, then why don't we return it? That's why I asked you to meet here. I had a suspicion as to what this was about. If you'd like, I'll have Narvin take you to Disables, and you can drop back off his toy.
But then won't we be missing out on what Marshall is creating right now? You're totally okay with just letting him fall into Disable's clutches?
I mean, sister, it's not my relationship, it's yours. I guess the question is, what are you okay with?
I just don't want Disable causing any other problems with everything we have to do right now. And he would probably be petty enough to do something.
Well, I certainly don't want to make anybody upset, so he is there to take if you wish. You have my blessing.
All right. I'll think over Storyteller, can I think over that and then do this the next day, or will I be getting a call from Disable?
He's going to call you every day.
Every day. Okay. Well, I'll wait for that phone call and let him know what, and try to talk my way out of that one, definitely.
I'm sure, and he will suggest an alternate arrangement where he comes here. That's not an option.
Oh, I figured that. I was hoping to set up a dummy location, but...
We can do that as well, as long as it ends with him taking Ellis back.
I'll wait for the phone call and see what he says. But I just want to let you, give you the heads up on what's happening and why I opted to say anything to Disable. And also so it doesn't blow up your phone.
I thank you for both of those things, and I trust your judgment. Honestly, if you thought that it was best to come clean with him, I don't necessarily disagree with you. You know him far better than I do.
Unfortunately.
Well, I will await your decision either way.
And then I just kind of motion towards the door and back out to K. Marshall Ellis.
K. Marshall, in his couple of days more work, has found new things that you can do with the blood. You might even call them level 2 powers under the blood technology that he's created. There are now, you can learn either a dupe or a distort to go with the disable. The dupe is basically just one rouse check, and then you use your wits and this discipline to create a little gaba vitae that will automatically gain a positive response from any electronic device.
Yes, please.
So if something is locked, it becomes open. If something is open, it becomes locked. It just basically goes to the opposite. So that is dupe. Distort also requires a rouse check, but that will go into an electronic system and literally distort any information about kindred, blank bodies, undead, anything like supernatural.
I look at the sister. It hardly seems sensible for us to have the same specialty.
Exactly. You could each take one of them if you like. Let K. Marshall teach it to you and practice it on some blender or something he has laying around.
Which would you prefer?
I have a tumultuous relationship with technology. If I can get it to cooperate more, I would definitely take that.
I'll accept that. And then I'll keep looking at Ellis and weighing the pros and cons of, do I really want Disabled to be able to do all this too?
That's another question you'll have to ask. Because if...
Julie will say, quietly enough that a human probably wouldn't be able to hear. It's a shame. As he teaches us, I'll just say, it's a shame to myself.
Yeah, to yourself.
She gets very pinched-faced. Goes to learn.
On the All Powers character sheet, you guys can go in and take one of each, the level 2 power there. One of you can have dupe, one of you can have distort. You'll also see metagaming, that there are more powers to come in the future. But
I see them, and now I'm even more.
Throwing this out there, too. Completely all original. These are
great.
Yeah, this is a little invention that I threw in because I thought it'd be interesting. And someday, I got to send it over to Onyx Path and say, look at what I did.
Look what I can do.
Yeah, maybe they'd like it.
Stuart, yeah.
But there you go. K. Marshall has gotten you a little bit further down his blood technology route. He's working towards the phones. Dusable is going to be a pest. And you'll do what you can about that. Lilith is AWOL for the night. You don't know where she is.
Okay.
Arthur was off doing his own thing for a while.
So I assume the next thing that we should probably do is visit the subway or the L so that we can get permission to go to the hospital.
And you can. Why wouldn't you?
Well, we should probably wait for... You don't know not to. We should probably wait for
Arthur's call.
You could also call him if anybody wants to. Does anybody want to initiate some communication?
Well, to invite him, absolutely, I'll give him a call.
There you go. Invite him to go on the L with you.
Yeah. Ring, ring, yeah, ring, ring, ring.
I'm going to download a ring phone.
Bonsoir, this is Arthur. How may I help you?
What a professional greeting.
Not like that last one.
I have my off days. If you're calling just to check up on me, it's your friendship is a treasure, but I have a feeling this is for something in particular.
No, how are you?
Drinks from his fuck your sensitivity cup and gives you the finger.
Yeah, it's just like that. I'm doing quite well. It's been a very productive day. You, I hope it's been all sunshine and roses for you.
Not a lot of sunshine, but the roses, sure.
I apologize. All idioms die hard, I suppose.
They do. What have you been up to? The sister and I were hoping to meet to continue our mission.
Continue mission in which capacity?
Well, I hardly think that we should discuss that over the phone.
Ah, well, I have some information I was able to suss up that might be worth sharing. Perhaps.
Fantastic. Meet by the L?
Yes. She was like, that sounds like a plan to me. I'll meet you there shortly.
Fantastic.
motherfucker.
He's up to something.
You are, sir?
Usually.
Well, yeah.
I mean, I'm all for it. I just thought you should know. I don't know what it is, but Arthur's saying that he's had a productive day and then not specifying what that is. You know. Let's go to the L and find out.
Really quick point of order for the it's maybe not retconny, but for Arthur to have a magazine of the Gangrel 9mm for his gun. Given his paranoid predilections, would that be beyond the, if I haven't said so already?
We did establish it as 9mm, didn't we?
I think there were CZ Scorpions, I believe, which are nine millimeter Luger.
I was trying to avoid 9mm because I knew you'd want to put it in your handgun.
Well, that's I wasn't asking for the handgun. I was mainly asking for, you know, specifics, and like that's my thing.
If you want the little Scorpion SMG, let's keep that ammo in that gun.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Okay. Then I probably wouldn't have that because those are.
Yeah, they're kind of big. You'd have to.
Chicago.
Julian will go to his office and take out his glove and put it in his inside jacket pocket.
Beautiful isotoner, like a driving glove. It's even got the strap around the wrist.
With the tips on it, huh?
But with the, Gangrel tips on the fingers.
I wonder if freaking Arthur will notice that. Y'all are crazy.
I'm not wearing it.
No, it's just tucked in his jacket right now.
You can't mess up at one point. He's going to put on the glove and then just like slap Arthur with it, or maybe like take it out and slap him in the face with the glove.
What a great idea. Hurt. Let me write that down as a note.
Yes, put that right next to meet with Uktena Elder, wear Indian headdress.
Because that always goes over well.
Okay. I will have Art Narvin drive us to wherever in the L we decide to meet. As we're driving, definitely would like to do an awareness roll to see if I'm being followed.
Wits awareness. Roll it and do good.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Okay.
Can his paranoia trigger my paranoia so I'll start looking around?
Why not? Even roll a, everybody could roll a wits awareness because I think you're all deeply paranoid enough.
Yeah.
You can also spend some willpower to re-roll stuff like that.
Yes. You see, we click the skill first and then the trait, right? When it asks for the thing.
Yeah, I like doing it from the exactly. Go from the skill to pick up the. So Julian, you got a 3. Out of your 4 dice, Narvin does a good job of driving. So he's also looking behind him and making sure that you're not being followed.
No.
But Chicago is a dense city.
Oh, should I roll for Narvin?
Oh, you can.
Yeah, I forgot to get Narvin Sheet in there for you too. Yeah, roll Narvin. Let's see how he does.
Okay.
My awareness fails. I'm still thinking about.
You're looking down at your feet, as far as I know. You're. What did you roll when you rolled your wits awareness? Did you roll your awareness plus your wits?
Yeah.
How come you only rolled one die?
On mine?
Yeah.
Because I have nothing in awareness.
Oh, that would be why then.
I'm not really paying attention. It's cool.
Let Jesus take the wheel.
She really puts faith is a whole thing for her.
Narvin, take the wheel.
And Narvin is pretty sure he lost whoever was behind him. Yeah. They couldn't possibly follow him.
That was
three. We were being followed. Okay.
And that was three for Arthur, a 10, a 7, and a 5 on the hunger die. So I guess it'd be down to 2.
Nobody sees anybody following them. But you're all confident that you weren't.
Okay.
Because that's what your dice say. Because when you look around, there's a confidence there too. You looked around.
We should probably be aiding each other's dice rolls or something if we're able to.
Maybe. Maybe.
Is that a thing? Can we do that?
You can. You can.
I won't be able to help anyone. I'm not.
You know, just ask. This is life, sort of. If we go to meet, I think the good place to meet is under the L.
Mm-hmm.
So this might bring back bad memories.
Has died and disappeared.
As Arthur gets off the L and goes down, what took you so long?
There, I don't need that.
Sorry, I didn't know you were so close.
I was on my way to you. It's fine.
Well, we should probably continue where we left off. We were going to meet with, what was his name again?
Evan Klein.
With Mr. Klein.
Evan Multiple Klein.
We're going to meet with Evan Klein, right? That's where we left off.
Yes, we The two of you are so good at talking to people. I would, of course, leave it to someone of your particular skills. If you wish, I can hang towards the back in case he decides to run for it. His reputation is that he is somewhat twitchy and tastefully insane.
Right. Although, I think we should all go together, right?
Of course, but as the backup and the muscle, I'm to be seen. Or not seen, not heard, until absolutely necessary.
Is that what this is?
Well, they don't want the asset to run or get spooked. You are an intimidating man in your own way, Julian.
So you should be heard and not seen? Is that how you feel?
In this instance, perhaps, yes.
Why this instance?
I think because one lone man on the train suddenly set upon by the three of us that would put me at ill ease. Do not think?
I think that we're not here on our own accord, so a little unease never hurt anybody, but I respect your candidness.
The L that is passing above you, the train, is about 3 cars long. You could tell that. If you were going to leave one person to hang behind, they could hang back in another car and still be on the train, but not in the same room.
Okay. For non-metagame, but like, yeah, I'd rather have Meta back anyway. I need the protection back there, especially after everything that's happened. So just make sure you keep a lookout, all right?
Oh, yeah. Julian has agreed. Yeah, absolutely. Of course.
I just realized I'm being all like sketchy and skeezy because I know what
to. Love you too. Of course I will be. Just you make the signal, cry out for help, wave your hands, or just think your guns at him, and I will come in and assist as needed.
My hero. Well, shall we?
You shall. Okay. Climbing up the stairs to go up into the L. The next train comes around quickly. The downtown loop is no more than just maybe a mile around. The train itself, like I said, just 3 cars long.
Most of it is empty except for you. And in the front car, there is a single figure just staring out the window, talking to himself.
Maybe you should go first. Wayward souls and all.
Mm-mm. Not in this getup. And he's a little crazy.
Very well. Okay. I'll walk up.
Yeah. Hi. Hi.
May I?
You want to sit? You can sit. Anybody can sit. It's a free car. It's a free country. Still a free country, at least for now. For now.
On the other, across the aisle way, so it's not, we're not crowding him. And I wave.
I sit so I'm on the side that can see down the car to where Arthur is, wherever that is.
All right. Yeah.
Mr. Klein?
Yeah, I'm Klein. Evan Klein. Evan Klein. Hi. Hi, I'm Evan Klein.
Hi, I'm Julian. I was sent to meet and talk with you.
A lot of meetings today. So many meetings today. Everybody wants to meet with Klein. Everybody wants to meet with Klein.
Really? Do you mind if I ask who else?
No, there was another one. There's always another one. There's another one. There's one there. There's one there. There's one there.
Man.
Fantastic. Well, I was sent on behalf of the prince to speak with you.
His features begin to change, not just shadowy kind of things and not just an obfuscation. His physical form begins to change. His face becomes a bit drawn. It's like, well, what does the prince want? Prince doesn't want nothing with me.
I don't believe he does, but no. But my coterie has been tasked with finding some visitors, and we believe that they might be in Malkavian territory, and we would, of course, not want to intrude without permission.
No, oh, I get it. You're like the other guy. You're looking for the hospital, right? You want to go to the hospital. You want to go to the hospital, and you, Tommy can't let you go to the hospital. Tommy doesn't have the authority to do that.
Oh, well. Can we speak to your manager?
His face will change again. And he will become a darker man, a black man, an African American, a bass player named Raymond Falcon. Say, baby, don't mess with my boy like that. You know, he's fragile.
Thomas. Oh, no. I meant no disrespect. I merely didn't want to trouble him with questions if he wasn't able to answer them. Oh, my apologies.
So, all these questions again, man. It seems like I'm answering the same thing. What is it you're looking for? You want to go to the hospital?
Yes. Although, if you've already spoken to someone, I would hate to replicate it. Yes, we're looking to. I'm looking to go on behalf of our coterie to the hospital.
Oh, man. Sending so many over there. Look.
Who else has been asking?
I'll tell you what I told the other guy, and that is Sun controls that territory, and he doesn't like visitors. You know, man, even I don't go out there because I don't get many gigs out that way, but, you know, I'm more of a downtown player. You get to meet night crowds, man.
Would you mind, what did this person look like that visited you before? What did they look like?
In the most shocking thing, his face changes yet again. And this time he looks, well, he starts to look like somebody very, very familiar to you.
Arthur Miss Newspaper is just like, what the fuck?
As this happens, Julian's expression is blank, but his eyes cut over past Evan to Arthur. Wow.
And then that
Arthur's face will go away and Evan Klein will be back. It's like, that's who did it. That's who I've been talking to. He came earlier. You know, same thing, same things. We told all the same things.
Okay. I look at the sister.
I look at Julian. Slide my eyes over to Arthur and then just quickly back to Julian and just...
It's a really quick thing to hide in plain sight, like newspaper thing. Okay,
yeah, just do a little stealthiness.
Cool. Dex plus stealth.
It's more of a wits thing at this point.
Cool.
Because you know it's awareness of who's looking at you.
Sure, yeah.
I'm looking at him. Do I contest that role?
Oh,
shit. I'm not hiding from you.
I'm not hiding from you guys.
Yeah, I don't know that. I didn't know that.
No. I'm purely hiding from the perp. All right. That is a 9, a 10, an 8, and a 1 on the second hunger die.
So it sounds like that's enough for you to dip behind a newspaper, Chicago Tribune.
That one moment, I'm just like, that motherfucker is stealing my face. Okay. Fantastic. I can work with this. Cool. All right. Carry on.
So you are successfully enough hidden behind a newspaper from Evan Klein and his multiple personalities. He won't notice you there in the next car.
Well, I thank you so much for your time. I certainly don't want to duplicate work. Sister, should we be...
No, I think we should be thorough, just in case. I know you've already answered these questions, but maybe he didn't ask the right ones, and this is very, very important to us.
You're right. If it's okay with you, Evan, could we speak to whoever we ultimately need to speak to? If it was the jazz player?
You mean about going to the hospital? Oh, my God. Son doesn't like that.
The last I heard, he disappeared, so we need to talk to the second person who could give us permission.
But here, you see, the thing is, I told the last guy, I'm like, you can go, but I figured it would just be him, you know, and Son would never ever find out. Now there's like two more of you.
It's actually total, another one.
There's going to be four of us.
Oh, no. Son finds out, he'll be very angry. Son will be very angry. I don't want him to be angry with me.
I don't want him to be angry with you either. I don't want him to be angry with us or the prince who asked us to come here. I don't want that to happen.
Rock in a hard place. Do you want Son angry at you or do you want the prince angry at you?
No.
I'm not threatening. I'm just asking because that's where we're stuck at now.
Right. We're all in the same train car together.
Oh, yes. I like that. Good one. That was out of character.
I kind of wish it was in. This is so perfect.
What do you want me to do?
All I know is that either Evan Klein is the one that tells us no, or someone else is the one that tells us no. If no is ultimately the answer, I would just much rather it not be Evan Klein that's saying no when we report back. You are pretty cool.
All right, you could talk to one of the other ones, but I don't, you know, nobody can tell you there. It's Son's territory.
I understand.
Nothing belongs to us.
I understand.
We don't go there.
Poor kid.
I look at the sister.
I really need to insist on speaking to someone else. If you don't mind, I'm so sorry.
The personalities of Evan Klein have not been cataloged. Sometimes people recognize certain characters that he is, like Raymond Falcon, like Tommy Holm, but nobody's actually sat down and figured out who they all are. So he can just start rolling through characters. He takes off his top hat and his hair slicks back. And you can stand there and say, I can't tell you to go to the hospital. I can tell you to stay away from the hospital. Don't go to the hospital.
Is there someone who can give us permission to speak to Sun?
Ooh.
Ooh.
Raymond Falcon comes back as baby. You want to talk to Sun?
I mean, I just want to be able to fulfill the prince's mission, and whatever that means. Maybe we should bring in the person that you spoke to before to help us out. Maybe he could expedite this.
Ooh, is that other one with you too?
He is.
I'll be right back. All of a sudden you see Calypso go into the Mother Superior walk.
Oh, that's a strict walk, man.
Oh, Marmaduke, you rascal.
Thank you, please. I was hoping you would do that. Yes.
Madame, I may be a civil assistant.
Yes.
Should I?
Do you want to?
Perhaps don't ask questions you don't want to answer, huh? So what did they say?
They want to speak to you. Again.
Of course. It's in here. I was hoping to see if there were answers that would be given differently. But if I'm brought in...
Come.
Of course. Time for Papa to get to work.
Raymond Falcon is still there. He'll see you come in and be like, hey, baby, good to see you again.
Hey, my friend Raymond. I must see you play sometime.
I'm on my way to a gig tonight. You should come on by.
I, you know, it is business before pleasure, but I was brought in by, I see you've met my esteemed compatriots.
You've got a big group here all of a sudden.
I did say I was going to be investigating with like-minded individuals in my coterie.
There's a lot of people. And again, his face will change. Go back to Evan Klein. You know, this isn't what we talked about, man. People are going to notice if you go there like a fucking army.
Now, so Evan and Ray, if you are still listening, and is Tommy, are you there too?
You know, we all are here, man. Just talk. So we're here.
You have all met my friends. Why? I'm remiss that the gentleman that came out to meet me before I departed at the conclusion of our business has not paid my friends in kind. We are all of the same ultimate desire here, I think.
Evan Klein's face will change to a face you have not yet seen the other members of the coterie, who sit up a little straighter, a little prouder. His chin will elongate and square out right at the end, a little dimple.
Is it just his face, or does his entire body like change in dimension?
You know, it seems he's sitting down, but you could swear he's taller.
That's creepy. Okay.
Yeah, so it's like he's putty, and like people are like, okay. So I wonder if it was just the face and posture, or if he's actually like, does he seem to be like
getting, when he like, takes on a new with one and yeah, when he takes on a new character, his entire physical form changes to match that character. Now, when he played you, his face just changed.
Mm-hmm.
To as a way of saying, like a picture, like, but when he has his own personalities, they seem to control his body morphing.
Okay.
So this last one is as proud and lucid a Malkavian as you've ever met. And he'll talk to you. Welcome back.
It's a pleasure to be back, my friend. I'm assuming, and forgive if this is making an ass of you and me, but I'm assuming that if you gained my name, even if directly to you, everyone in your, everyone in your council knows?
We are aware.
Then, as you have me at a disadvantage, I would not know your name, monsieur.
Oh, well, I figured since you were
talking about snowmen, you knew who I was. Pleased to meet you. I'm Frank Gogan.
And it's like, a pleasure indeed. I've heard much about you, Monsieur Gogan.
Well, thank you. All good, I hope.
Of course, just took me by surprise. And then in my hurry to avoid looking starstruck before someone as esteemed as yourself.
Yeah, you can stop blowing that smoke anytime.
Yeah.
Tell me what you need.
I thought you were dead. I mean, dead, second dead.
I don't know what you mean. As Mark Twain said, reports of my death.
Wait, hold on. Out of character wise, was that something that we were all told, or was that just something I found out? We were all told.
No.
Okay.
No. We were all told.
That's what I'm saying.
I think Julian is putting it together. So I think I'm definitely at a disadvantage. Do you have a relationship with snowmen, Mr. Gogan?
I thought we established that, yes. I hired him.
Right. If you mind me asking, what specifically did you hire him to do?
Well, we had to stop the invasion. Those La Sombra coming to town are deeply dangerous people.
That's true. You're not wrong. I guess my question is, we were sent by the prince. I don't know what it is he would like us to do with that information.
Doesn't matter to me. I'm here.
So do we have permission to pursue the prince's goal for us?
I wish you'd speak a little more plainly there.
I'm sorry. I don't know what was discussed earlier. The prince would like us to bring in the Yeri Coterie, which includes Snowman, as he's referred to.
Oh, so the prince doesn't like it.
I'm not sure what the prince does or does not like. I'm not in his inner circle like that.
I have to admit, I didn't know that the prince would not approve. By my mind, he should have endorsed every bit of this action.
Right. I mean, based off of what I've read, you're nothing if not loyal. And that goes for all of your, coterie. So yes, I believe this is probably all a large misunderstanding.
So that's what you want?
To bring in the Gary Coterie, yes. Maybe the hospital is not the place to go to do that. I mean, I've heard that they rest in the open cemetery as well.
That's safe. It's a haven, you know.
Right. Of course. But they have to enter and exit it to do business.
True enough. My business with the coterie was protection for the Camarilla, for my city,
of course,
for my people. And for my friend's son. Protecting him is important.
And if it goes against what the prince wishes?
That I did not know.
Or potentially puts son in conflict with the prince's desires? Or
son is a strange bird. He may not have been as truthful with me as I would have wanted.
Oh, son asked you to do this on his behalf.
Well, I do owe him. I owe him for saving my life.
I respect your loyalty. But I guess, did you do this unbeknownst to son, or?
No, son told me the whole tale. The Sombra coming to take down the Camarilla. They're sending insurgents to... infiltrate our ranks.
Right.
He was terrified.
Understandably so.
I said I could deal with this for him. And he said, do it. And there I've gone.
Here we are. Well, I, first of all, thank you for your loyalty above
candor.
And your candor, yes.
I have no reason to lie to you.
Of course not.
Done nothing wrong.
As far as I'm concerned, I mean, I'm just sent on a mission, as are the members of my coterie. But we do thank you for your time.
But you've done nothing wrong, that is true. But now that you know the prince is against this action, can you call back your coterie to stop them from any further action? Or would that be in conflict with what you feel you owe, son?
I haven't been in contact with him since I hired him.
How did you get in contact with him?
It's easy enough to find some disenfranchised youth out in Gary. Took me all of a couple of hours in an evening. Nothing at all.
He's right, you know.
Thank you, Arthur. If we wanted to get in contact, if you wanted to get in contact with them, let's just say Sun asked you to, would you be able to?
Well, I was supposed to leave a mark when things were safe.
Safe just, for them to leave?
Yeah, just a mark. There's a mausoleum in the open cemetery, set towards the back. It's got some open boxes. Sometimes we can use a dirt floor where a gangrel can, you know, do that thing they do. But I was supposed to go in there and leave a mark when the coast was clear, as it were.
Do you mind sharing what that mark was?
He'll show it to you. It's drawn on the window with his breath. It's a standard Nosferatu symbol. It's just one of those kindred things that gotten passed down over the years. This is a safety symbol, kind of an all clear.
And then they would leave the open cemetery, I presume, to head back to where they...
Yeah.
Okay. I look at the sister.
Now that we have kind of an understanding and you are now aware that the prince wants the La Sombra delegates, not infiltrators, delegates to be protected so he can meet with them and then decide their fate. Once we find your hired coterie, you understand we have to bring them in.
These are the ways of war. I understand. I took myself a disenfranchised group out of Gary for a lot of reasons. Expendability would be one of them.
Then we have an understanding. Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Gogan.
Tell me before you leave.
Welcome to Chicago. It is late at night, so let us play.
And welcome, everybody, to Windy City Kindred, my vampire show on Saturdays. It is, it's early for us. I hope everybody's awake. I got my coffee. I see Alex has his coffee. How are you guys doing, my cast? We are without Lilith again today, and an announcement for everybody. We'll be off next week taking our mid-season break, and we'll come back after that with 6 straight episodes that brings us into the end of this storyline. Oh, it's getting exciting. Last week, we cut off a little bit early for technical problems, issues beyond our control, literally beyond our control. So a quick recap. At that point, we were riding the L with our coterie as they had just discovered that
multiple Klein, a crazy Malkavian with personality issues, actually has a hidden personality of Frank Gogan, the man who went to Gary to hire the coterie that has caused you all so many problems. I think that will catch us right up to where we were, because you hadn't even left the L yet when our lines went dead. Here we are. We're back at it. We're going to stitch these two together so it becomes like one big long episode. This one will be a little bit shorter today so that we don't have like a 5-hour episode that goes up on YouTube. But how about that? How's everybody doing? How about
that indeed? Well, are we restarting like our roles and everything?
We shouldn't need to start any roles, because at the time that you were leaving the L, it was 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. There was still nighttime to be had, and decisions to be made, whatever you guys wanted to do. We did not get to a rest point. I was going to just kind of pick it up right from that. Imagine you have just stepped off the train. You are standing on the platform as the train pulls away, and in the front car, you can see Evan Klein talking to himself in the reflections in the window as he zips off, probably out to a gig.
I'm going to wait. I'm not going to say anything first. I'm going to wait.
Arthur, you had asked, and I don't think it got answered on the stream, but you had asked where he plays as Raymond Falcon, the I believe the trumpet player.
Oh wait, the jazz musician.
Jazz musician. He plays at a place called the Flute and Horn. It's a reputable high-end blues and jazz club. Center City, closer to the beach, but has a very excellent reputation, so he must be a good musician.
Excellent reputation. At least it's another point where we can catch up to him if need be.
He doesn't seem to be hard to find. By all reports, this is his office that you just left. So.
I'm going to look at the sister, but while I'm doing that, the shadows around me are growing thicker, more tangible.
Is this a response to your emotional state?
It is.
So it's what
it's kind? Not necessary. It's not necessarily conscious.
Yeah, but it's also
under the overhang. You see, like, the shadows that normally are pushed back by the streetlights are kind of dripping down the columns around me.
Is this...
If someone were to be looking at them.
Is this anger? Is this frustration?
That's a human emotion, but you could assume so.
Yeah, all right. You tried to distance yourself from such plebeian things as human emotions, but your shadows tell all. Sister, how are you feeling? Or Calypso?
At this point, I'm just like, if he's looking at me and he has the anger rolling off of him, I'd be kind of concerned, and I'm like, everything okay?
I look at Arthur. I don't know, Arthur. Is everything okay?
I see no reason why it would not be. We have what we came for. We are more informed.
It is worth noting to anyone who missed the cutoff between this episode and the last episode. You did sort of visit Evan Klein twice. Arthur discovered him first and had a lovely conversation, unbeknownst to the rest of the coterie. You did try to hang back during that second conversation, but I think Julian's put it together.
It's just classic vetting. It's to make sure that they their story stays on the straight and narrow.
Oh, the secrets between you all.
Is that
where's
what you were
the
doing?
Trust?
Making Wait. Sure that he couldn't hide anything.
Wait, it's something that you would typically do. You have one individual question and the let's call him a suspect, and then once they've answered that panel of questions, you have someone else questioned in a different way. And if the answers come up the same, chances are they are truth.
You don't normally have the other person also in the room while you do that. You also don't necessarily hide that from the good cop, which you did, which makes me wonder whether or not this is you being candid or whether or not this is you trying to cover your ass.
Oh, dear.
Well, I would prefer to have not been brought in so that way any surprise could have been maintained. But his trick with the face was very interesting. That is, you are well within your rights to believe me or not. I have nothing to hide.
Julian is going to Julian is going to start walking around Arthur, and as he walks, the area that he steps away from is going to remain dark.
In defiance of all that you know of science, light, photographic and photogenic effects, the light just can't seem to push past Julian. He leaves a black trail behind him.
Okay. I know you're a little peeved. What he does say does make sense. I'm sure he would have come clean. It's kind of like when Marshall was taken. It took a day before I was told, so he might have come clean. Let's not fight right now. Besides, we need him in one piece to talk to the prince, right?
Napoleon is growling.
It's okay, boy. There's not a price on my head. At least not yet. Killing you would be very bad, especially when you have no friends. No one particularly to fall back on.
Killing? How gauche.
If it walks like a duck and talks like a duck, then I am obviously that duck.
Nice cup.
I'm going to step close to Arthur, right next to Napoleon. And I'm going to say, you have one opportunity. Just one. To admit that you fucked up. The only thing worse than a sneaky person is a sneaky person that gets caught and doesn't admit it. This is our opportunity to come to an agreement. You tried it. It didn't work.
Contrary, so, I think it did. We know the man's name.
Very well. Have it your way. And the shadows will disappear. Well, what's our next destination?
I think, as you said, we go speak to the prince, or we. I think could be me, if you are so inclined.
Wow, you've been so trustworthy.
Of course.
I'm fine with it, Malenry. I'm sorry, Malenry. Sister, Calypso.
Sure. Let's go. Being here is bad. Let's go. Come on.
To where would you like to be off? Or who would you like to contact?
Is the prince's when there's not a liaison being held, is his general place of business commonly known?
You know where the his Primogen Council meets, but no, you don't know where he usually, you know, lays his head for the day, things that he tries to keep to himself. You can always call Damien. Damien can get in touch with him anywhere he is.
That was a hard second. Okay.
He is your point of contact for this. He is the sheriff.
He is. And among many other things,
you just don't like the voice. You just don't like hearing his voice.
Like I love to hate it. if that makes sense. But yeah. It will ring up. There's a good old sheriff.
I still didn't import a ringtone, but I'm going to do that because I love that idea. But you'll pick up Damien on the phone and he'll give you, meow, what's up?
Sounds like a race car. Damien, we have some information regarding the Garrett Coterie. I'd like to appraise the prince of the situation.
So you think you got enough information to go straight to the prince? What do you got?
Something too delicate to be spoken of over the phone.
All right.
Perhaps if it was just you and the prince, but if he's so inclined to bring along others of the Primogen Council, it is entirely his prerogative. I would advise against it.
Did you say advise against it?
Oui. There's anyone who might have ties to the old administration, if you get my meaning.
Oh no! I smell an inside job.
That's just yes. It does smells very bad. Yes.
Right. You remember that first place where you met up with the prince? Yeah, you can go back there. It's the museum.
Yes, I.
All right. Look, we ain't got a lot of time. If we're gonna do this tonight, we need to get there pretty quick.
I am on my way as I speak.
All right, we'll be there. And he'll hang up and mercifully save you from the rest of his phone call.
Okay. All right.
I should mention, early on, when you had heard some of Damien's baby chorus music, you had reached out to some of the people at the OMG to see if there was something they could do for him.
Mm-hmm.
Your idea was a quirky Wes Anderson film where it might do good as one of the soundtrack pieces.
Yes.
An excellent idea, in fact. And OMG has put some representatives in touch with Baby Chorus to try to make that happen.
Bring people together.
The next time you see Damien, he should know about it so you can mention it to him. At least that's the word you've gotten. The International Museum of Surgical Science, absolutely one of my favorite places in all of Chicago. Weirdest goddamn museum you will ever see. Featuring every bit of surgical technology throughout history, from chiseling holes in people's skulls all the way up to the modern Da Vinci machines that can do surgery on a grape. And if you've never seen that YouTube video, watch that YouTube video, Surgery on a Grape. It's just flat out amazing. But here at the museum on the second floor, there is a hall of immortals. Statues line either side of the room, and it's an imposing place. Marble and plaster, there it is. It's way at the end. Hang on a second. Oh no! Shit. I am very sorry. I just jumped out of Roll 20 by complete accident. I'm coming back.
These things happen.
Sometimes it's touchy, man. It's trying to move the thing around and...
Gosh darn technocrat mages.
Somebody's working their magic on me. I'm not taking you to Juliet's condo. I'm not taking you. There we go. Got to make this easier on myself somehow. There we go. The International Museum of Surgical Science with their immortal statues lining the halls. It is, of course, not daylight as it would appear in this picture, but the deep dark of night, pushing almost 4 o'clock in the morning now. By the time you get over there, by the time you've made your call and had your conversations and tried to figure this whole thing out. Damien is here, but you don't see the prince, at least not immediately. He needs to know what you have to say.
Is my Godric going with me, or am I going into the wolves, or the, I guess, let's call it the lion's den by myself?
We'll walk behind. Yeah.
Oh, solidarity, yeah. I love you. Yeah. Very good.
Well, we'll walk behind.
Look, Damien?
You know, he looks around, makes sure it's just you. He looks out in the hall. He looks out the windows. All right. We're alone, at least mostly, you know. So what is it?
The prince is too busy to have come for this vis-a-vis.
Don't worry about that.
Don't insult the sheriff.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, because we got some stuff. Thank you.
I always believed in you guys.
I think it's gonna sound good. Never mind. Let's get back to this.
Yes. Thank you for meeting with us, Sheriff Damien. That is what I'm sure Arthur meant to say. Go ahead, Arthur.
Yes, of course. So we met our contact, Evan Klein, and his one man posse.
Klein's a funny dude. You know, you can invite him to a party and it's the only guy you need to invite.
Are you familiar with the many faces of this man?
Yeah. I know like, I don't know, three, maybe four. It's hard to tell, you know.
There was one that not many seem to be acquainted with. Very tall, chin like a sledgehammer. Called himself Frank Gauguin.
Wait a minute. Wait, Evan, multiple Klein has a Gauguin?
Whether that is the original article or someone he adopted over time, I am not sure. But by Gauguin Klein's own admission, he is the one that tasked the Gary Guthrie.
Well, he is the one that fulfilled another's request.
I don't understand any of this, to be honest with you. I mean, I don't understand how Klein is Frank Gauguin.
Well, he demonstrated the ability to adopt faces that he's seen before.
Yeah, but I don't... How would he know Frank Gauguin?
Apparently, the Gary Guthrie was not brought together just on his order. He was doing someone very close to him a favor.
Oh, and yes. We had to have a private conversation because of the closeness of this person?
You are the sheriff. You are putting two and two together very nicely.
From behind one of the larger statues, you will hear a man say, "Son of a bitch!" And that first... the prince will step out and make his presence known. Son of a bitch. Am I right?
Correct. Yes.
This does make some sense. So, multiple Klein isn't actually at fault.
He believed he was doing it on your behalf.
Gogan was a venture, proud man, an honorable man. He never would have done anything to put this city in harm's way. God, if I could have 10 of him today. But son, I knew his obsession with the La Sombra ran deep. I had no idea it ran this deep. You need to find the Gary Coterie. How is that coming?
We have a location.
I'd like to hear from the Gangrel, if you don't mind.
Oh, of course.
Or the Majesty. Sister.
Sure. Should I step out?
Stay. Shh. Seen, but not heard. Like children.
Of course.
So, what do we know about the Gary Coterie? Where are they? They're dangerous now.
As we are aware that a couple of their number pull up in the open cemetery. It is marked by some sort of Nosferatu safety glyph, but no word that is that they may stay. If reports are to be believed, they come in just before the sun goes down.
And that is why we were speaking to Multiple Klein. We were trying to get permission to go in so we wouldn't cause a turf war. As you said, we're trying to keep the bloodshed to a minimum.
If they're staying in the open cemetery, I have a problem. It's a no-kill zone. It has to remain that way. Otherwise, other kindred won't stay there. Even if I open a blood hunt on the Gary Coterie, I don't want you to kill them in the cemetery. But they need to be taken care of. The cemetery has to be holy ground, you understand? If I betray that compact for these, I won't have the trust of others. So, lure them out. Take them out. Get them on Camarilla ground and end them. As for Sun and Klein, well, Klein has done nothing wrong, but I'd love to talk to Frank Gogan. That's just sort of to himself. Sun will be dealt with in a different fashion. But keep it quiet. He can't know that we're coming for him. And believe me, I am. The prince, without a further word, will take his leave, go out the back door, and leave you alone with Damien.
Well, that seems pretty clear. You gotta find him, you gotta take care of him. And we'll set up something for Sun. Something, you know, clever.
You are nothing if not clever, I think. I put it in your capable hands.
Believe me, it's hard to outthink a Malkavian, you know, because they're just so fucking crazy.
Do you have any suggestions on how we can lure the Gary Coterie onto Camarilla land? Because I'm at a loss right now on how to do that.
Well, you know.
Besides dangling the La Sombra delegates as bait, and also finding the other La Sombra delegate.
Yeah, that'll come up too pretty soon here. But first things first, look, they come and go from there. That cemetery, that's what you need to know.
I have a way, but I wasn't allowed to speak. It was so unfortunate.
You can talk to me, just, you know, don't, he, you know how he feels about it.
I appreciate your understanding, Sheriff. one of the pieces of information we were able to get from multiple Klein is that there's a symbol that means safety, that is a symbol for the Gary Coterie to leave the cemetery.
If you know what that symbol is, you know, use it.
I do.
I mean, that seems like a good idea, right? Look, you know, the imagination's all up to you. Just make it happen.
It's better than the draconian method I had in mind, which was that slip that there's certain vampires within a certain crypt to certain men of a particular hunting type.
I don't know if I'm following you, but
we're hanging them out to dry for the enterprising men we encountered earlier.
Well, look, here's another thought. You know, there's four of them, four. So, you know, you probably only need to get your hands on one to make the other three come running for you. So don't, you know, don't try to get them all at once. That would be bad because you probably wouldn't. But if you can get one of them, that's the one you want to dangle as bait.
Well, I guess we have a small bit of a plan. And they're all going to be dead, correct? We're not trying to capture for interrogation or anything. They have a death sentence on their head.
Well, I think we know all we need to know at this point, right?
All right. I believe so.
Yeah. If you want to turn them into ash and then throw that ash in the river or the lake.
I'm not going near that lake, but no, I understand what you mean.
Yeah, exactly. All right, then. I gotta go because I gotta get into the studio and do a remix on this one so we can send it off to Hollywood. And you know, thank you again for that.
Can we get a small demo?
Oh, yeah. Here, I got it on my phone. Let me turn it up a little bit.
What do they use now? When they remix things and the I think someone like T-Pain did it.
Auto-tuning?
Yeah, just a little, because
I'm gonna use some of that. So you use some of that hard reverb in there.
Yeah.
By Chicago. Yeah. It's good.
Arthur, you're a fan of music, right?
Wait. Solo part. Just break it down.
You know what? This is great workout music too. I really get one in like the warm up mood. Arthur, you own a series of gyms, don't you?
Just the one for the ours are more of the heavy metal clientele.
You know, I'm gonna forward this over to you. Maybe you could just put this on a little bit of a loop and see if you know maybe I'm gonna hit the bag a little bit harder. I'm pretty sure.
Oh yeah, it's kind of like that training montage music, right? Uh-huh. Oh geez,
training montage. Great idea.
It's definitely like a music that gets that really makes the blood proverbially run hot. It makes me really want to hit something. This is true. Yes. I really want to.
You guys say the best things.
You are a unique individual. You are
Julian walks out.
You know, you are a treasure. It's
good, you know, to have fans and to you know have people believe in you. And you know, I.
Those are some very strong words, and I'm sure you believe them.
All right. Well, we'll see you soon. Hopefully, with better news than this last one.
Damien will take all of your backhanded compliments without realizing how insulting they actually are. And you are back in the streets of Chicago. It is very close to sunrise now. You've probably only got about an hour to go. Enough time to get back to your respective havens.
Yeah. I'll call Narvin to pick me up.
There we go. Let's bring you to the city map.
As I get into my car, I'll say, yeah, I have so much of that information from Flyboy to go over.
You can review, you know, the information that you've gotten, try to put some more connections together, but you have already put out a feeler to Fiorenza to try to put this whole Flyboy situation together into a framework that makes sense.
He was just being a douche.
Yes.
It doesn't really connect. You've got Flyboy and unreasonable amount of resources on his part. But you don't know where the resources come from. You have a name, but that name doesn't seem to go back to anything in particular. It's probably just a fake identity. So Julian has reached up to the highest heights to try to put that together. And more than likely, you'll receive another phone call in a night. So you, how is everybody doing on their hunger? Does anybody need to feed before they rest?
Very good question.
We'll assume then that everybody's going back to their respective havens. Arthur, you're going back to the gym. Mm-hmm. Julian, going back to either your condo or your home.
My home.
It's a home. I'm going to hitch a ride since I had a ride coming this way.
Oh.
Yeah. I'll drop her off.
She's a little out of your way. It'll take you just a little bit longer to get home.
Is Arthur closer?
No, he's downtown. She's over by the airport. You're straight north if you go into the house.
If she needs a ride, I'll give her a ride.
It gives you plenty of time to review your notes. So everyone will make it back. We do not have Lilith with us for this coming evening. Oddly, though, when you manage to talk to her, or, you know, get a little bit of communication going, she knows almost all the same things you do. She's excited to tell you that Frank Gogan is actually Evan Klein, who's a shape-shifting Malkavian with multiple personalities. She's anxious to tell you that the Gangrel are staying in the open cemetery, and a little disappointed when she finds out you already know all of this. Oh, well.
At least she has reliable contacts.
Unless she unfortunately spoke to him a third time, I bet you multiple clients like being pissed off.
That would be so funny.
Yes, you don't know the circumstances behind it or how she managed to accomplish such a thing, but on her own and just with her own resources, found just about everything you did. So rest then, Coterie. And you will rouse the next evening. So roll some rouse checks. Let's see how your hunger is doing the next night. That was a Tuesday, by the way. This will be a Wednesday evening that you're rousing for and waking in. Well, Julian is feeling a bit peckish.
Did you say that we sated our hunger the night before, or are we just...
Well, what was your hunger the night before?
Two.
It was two?
And this would definitely bring me up to three.
Let's say you're at three, then.
All right. Excellent.
You know, you wake with a growling in your stomach. You wake with your own dog growling at you. Like, your stomach rumbles and your dog goes...
I know,
damn well better go eat and kill something.
Angry boy.
But here we are. It is Wednesday evening. You have a lot of information. You have a lot of different irons in the fire. What do you each wish to do? Arthur, you're hungry. Julian, a little peckish.
And sister, you're fine.
Arthur's going to go strip the day off, right, and go mug someone.
Hop in the van or the car.
Yep.
Take Napoleon, run up to the rack. 20 minutes away or so. Roll your strength brawl and we'll see how your feeding goes.
Oh man, but I don't have this many right red dice. Okay. Hunger. That is 2 6 7. Oh, there's a 10. Could I use my grapple specialty?
Well, this is your feeding, so it's already it's an automatic.
All right, so, okay, so that's a 10, a 7, and yeah, that's it.
A 10 and a 7? So that's actually going to give you 3 successes, which for your feeding is fine. You can't really fail a feed except if you get no successes and then you just try again. This time, in a reasonable amount of time, you will find the person that you were looking for. Grab them quickly, drag them to the ground, feed as quickly and unobtrusively as you can, and then just punch them a couple of times and take their wallet. It feels like a mugging. It seems like a mugging. With a little bit of your vitae, you can clean up the marks on the neck.
Huh. Well, we'll probably go a little more than is necessary because he's a little mad about yesterday.
Oh, are you planning on slaking all of your hunger, or are you just gonna give him a little extra tap?
Yeah, make it look extra convincing, like he definitely owed one of those types of money. Yeah, he's going to break some ribs.
Excellent. Not excellent for this poor son of a bitch, but excellent for you.
Hey, if this is not me, if this is fine.
Yeah. Stand him back up. Give him a shot right there to make it completely obvious. You hear the cracks. He goes down. He's having a hard time breathing.
It's like music through my ears, huh?
You could even throw him a warning. You're like, and let that be a lesson to you. He won't know what you're talking about, but he will let it be a lesson to him.
Yeah, he'll slip into some guttural German. It's just,
oh, even like, better, because yeah,
like this is the last time you mess with the Frankfurter brothers. Do not do it again.
He's trying to plead for his own innocence, but he can barely breathe. And he's like, I don't know what you're talking about. he's had enough. And you can slake all but one of your hunger since you did not kill him. That should help you at least breathe easier for the rest of the evening. So, plans. Scheme.
Yeah, I got some plans.
Some schemes.
Yeah. Is there someone in law enforcement that Julian, I have a contact. I have two contacts that I haven't defined, that have not been defined yet.
Okay.
And I'm thinking I might want one of them to be like in law enforcement or the FBI.
I can absolutely allow that because, like you said, it's been undefined. And if you, as long as this person is forever, either, let's say, local cop up to detective or an FBI agent for the regional office.
Sure.
Just a regular agent.
Someone who I just want him to have. I want to throw him a bone. I want to say that I have a tip on something that could be very interesting for him.
Ooh, yeah. Okay. What kind of, where are you trying to send him?
Before I do that, I'm going to agree to the deal, the art deal.
Yes, for the Nazi medal and the accompanying trinkets that he also threw in on the deal.
Yeah, whatever the price he had, I'll agree to it.
Again, we're going to be very ambiguous about price since it's all going from you to him and from him to somewhere else. So it all happens. And in your possession, you will end up with some
Well, that's the tip. So I just want a little bit of the money back. But whoever I send, I'm just going to let my buddy know that there's going to be a drop-off, an exchange of goods and services. And he can arrest whoever he finds, and he can keep half of the money. Just return the other half to me. And he can keep the items, too.
You are sending one of your own retainers to do this, though. You know, it's... He'll end up getting arrested, too.
For a little bit.
Really, guys? We're going to go this route?
So at the point of sale, you want your friend from either local law enforcement, probably the FBI, since they track this sort of thing, a young field agent. This would be a good get for him.
An up-and-comer, yeah.
Yeah, it would definitely work on in his benefit. He will end up crashing this exchange.
Oh.
And arrest you, the man acting on your behalf, and Arthur, the man acting on your behalf, will end up getting arrested as well for dealing in Nazi artifacts stolen, presumably. That's really the only thing they have against him.
It's Craigslist. There's no so legal about that, huh?
And he'll collect the money, and I'll get half the money back.
When the FBI field report is filled out, it is odd that there is only half of the amount of money listed. The other, that which becomes the total amount of money that was found, oddly. Julian, you'll get half of your resources back on that one. Arthur, you will lose possession of your items, and your man will be arrested.
So unfortunate.
I don't know how this was to be avoided.
Anyway.
There's always a sad day when Chicago is its finest.
Even I don't understand what you're doing at this point.
Let's get that guy bailed out. We'll use part of the recovered money to bail him out and give him a little bit of change, extra change, to thank him for his troubles.
In the end, it'll end up costing you that entire resource, so...
Totally fine. I just made a new friend. Arthur didn't get any money out of the deal, and he lost his items. Sounds good to me.
But did you know it was Arthur? That's the thing.
Yes.
He did.
Oh, yes, did. Shit. Shit. Sorry.
Okay. I'm
staying at my damn convent.
The safest place.
I'd rather have a phone call from Disable right now. Go ahead, hit me with it. I'm kidding. Please don't.
This is why I have to watch these episodes over in the following week, because the twists and turns are even boggling my mind. All right. Well, Julian, you've made it happen.
Mm-hmm. Wait, does Arthur know that Julian was the buyer?
I believe he does.
Oh, I hate you both so much right now. This is stressful.
Oh, this is interesting.
He does not know, and please don't metagame it, but he does not know that it was a setup, but he does know that his man and Julian's man were both taken in this.
I just want to make sure. He did know it was me. Just making sure.
I believe he knew that this was on your behalf. Yeah. Am I correct, Arthur?
No, see, because I'm confused when they found out when they knew who was who, because on the last episode, this whole deal was done by, you know, proxy, complete proxy.
Yes. So it was. Like, it was done by proxy on both ends.
I reached out because I knew it was Arthur, but I didn't think that he knew it was me. But if he does, it's still fine. Message sent, but I didn't think he knew it was me.
I'm fine either way. It's just storyteller's prerogative.
No, I figured you kind of had, I think we talked about it, you had the feeling that this one coming in was from somebody with some resources who had
someone with the with the money, who wanted something showy.
And you knew someone was looking into your background a little bit. So
that's, yeah. And so
your own paranoia would have led you to Julian.
Yeah, it would have led it to like Julian and like a few others of like that 1% or so. Also, he has an inkling.
Okay.
But I wouldn't say he's got it like pinpointed just yet.
Now, that's Byer. As for what actually happened, this was FBI, you don't know. You don't have an inkling that this had anything to do with Julian, since his man got arrested too. Both of your guys went down. You assume all the money was gone, and you assume that all the product is gone. Locked into evidence somewhere.
Right. But also, he also assumed that he should be getting a phone call from Julian in a rage about, you know, being betrayed and having his guy like arrested.
No, they don't. They have not played this to each other.
This is unfortunate. This obviously means that there might be a mole. So, only recourse is to perhaps send a different kind of message. I'll contact one of my criminal contacts and ask for someone to do some digging on the enterprising detective's name,
his address, his family.
Your man can find it. It'll take a little time.
And when the time is right, I will gas explosions and old Chicago buildings. It's tragedy.
Infrastructure around here is very dated. Anything, accidents can happen.
The pipes, man.
Yes. Chicago has such a history with fires.
Fires and gas explosions, they reduce places to rubble pretty quick.
I will make a call. I want to the sister. I want to see if she's made a decision.
About Dusable.
Mm-hmm. At this point, as the phone call is happening, I'm actually out with I almost said Ari.
Grace.
No. That's not her
character. Lilith.
Lilith, thank you. I'm out with Lilith at the cemetery doing our freaking job and putting the symbol on there and getting the fuck out.
You're doing it?
No. Just, with all the stuff that's back and forth between the boys and like the girls are actually gonna do the job and then, you know, just like put the symbol there.
It's hump day.
Yeah, life imitates art. That's kind of how this happens normally in my experience.
Yeah.
Lilith was surprised a couple of episodes back at how human all of the undead emotions seemed to be. I was like, no, that doesn't go away even after you prolong your life and become a vampire. You're still petty, jealous, manipulative. You're everything you were in life. Mm-hmm. Each of you.
So I will ask her if she's made a decision.
He hasn't called yet, but when he does, I'm going to try to make it so that way we can keep Marshall Ellis. Only because with what we're learning right now, I don't want him to have all of that knowledge to himself. He's already an interesting individual. And whatever he learns, I want us to be able to learn so we can have a backup just in case. And if you don't want to keep him, because for some odd reason, I don't know your motivations on that, but I really do think it would be safer if everything that Dusable could get from him, we could get from him too.
Oh, that's fine. I'm not the one in contact with him, so I'm not the one that has to tell him no.
Yeah, it's going to be fun, but we'll see. It's not really a hard no. It's a yes with caveats that he has to give in to, hopefully. But we'll see what it costs me.
If you need anything, let me know.
Okay.
On the subject of K. Marshall Ellis, you've received the new blood technology powers that he's created. And you can apply them each. You know, you can use them whenever you like. He will tell you that V-phone is coming right along. He will have some shortly, and he can tell you how they're going to work. The V-phone has no battery, And that is one of the unique things about it. It will never run out of power because it powers itself from your vitae. When you click it on with your thumb, your finger, whatever, it takes a tiny sample. And with that sample, it identifies who you are. It collects and stores your information, and it turns on for you. Oddly, if another kindred tries to turn on your phone, they will only see their information, not yours. It is tied to the vitae itself, so that each phone is unique regardless of whether or not it's unique. The other thing is the screen is black unless you have auspex or heightened senses or some way to see things that you otherwise cannot see. To a mortal, they'd never be able to see anything on it, hear anything on it, nothing. But you can.
So to a mortal, it's just a chunk of plastic and metal.
It won't even turn on. Yeah. And if it did turn on, they wouldn't be able to read what's on it or see what's happening. But it does mean you do have to have some kind of heightened senses when you go to read it or use it. The other thing is you can send communications through it. They are safe, secure. You can send video of yourself. You can talk any language you want to talk.
I can use it to see what I'm going to wear.
It is a yes. And for you, Lysandra, it works. It doesn't have a technology minus. This thing just works. It works 100% of the time. It always videos you. It always picks up your audio. It is tied the world directly to you.
I'm going to change the world.
You can with 10 phones, which will be ready in just a couple more nights.
Okay.
But these are the other unique thing about this communication system is it will always work between your phones. Now, if you need to call somebody else who doesn't have a V phone, you're going to need a proper cellular connection, that kind of thing. But if you were ever out of service, you can always contact the other V phones, no matter what.
Gotcha.
The other thing that you receive, Julian, is word from Fiorenza. She sends you caution. Be very, very careful. Flyboy and Daniel Bailey are directly connected. Daniel Bailey is Flyboy's connection, handler, superior in whatever organization they're in. Flyboy reports directly to this Daniel Bailey. Daniel Bailey is a mask identity with no history. And for Fiorenza to tell you that means it is one of the highest priority no backgrounds that she's ever seen.
So I would assume that she's very interested in it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When she looks into somebody's background, she doesn't get blank pages back.
Great.
And Daniel Bailey is a blank page.
So I'm going to tell her, I'm just going to step back. This is obviously beyond me. And I have every confidence in her abilities and vast network.
If you put, if you fill her in with the information that you were actually attacked by First Light agents and that it never was cleaned up by any kindred and never reported by any mortals, she will tell you this is the highest level of government. This is the Inquisition. This is the kind of thing they can do. She doesn't have the direct connection between Flyboy, Daniel Bailey, and Black Site 24 or First Light. But when she does, that is what you're going to need to take to the council.
To the council?
The Primogen Council of Chicago is going to need to know about
this. Well, she didn't just say the prince. She said the council.
The council.
Very well.
This will help pave your way with the prince, And perhaps next time you are in a room with him alone, he won't ask you to be seen and not heard.
But he did speak to him. That's cool.
But she is telling you to be careful because this is the most dangerous man you've ever found.
Bailey, not Flyboy, right?
Well, yeah, Flyboy because of Bailey. Let's say that.
Got it.
The danger there goes beyond anything even Malenkov could do. Malenkov may be a danger like one-on-one if you ran into him in a dark alley, but Flyboy is going to call the wrath of the Inquisition down upon you. So tread carefully. Arthur, you also had a couple of irons in the fire because you had been looking for some new talent to fill in for some of the men that got injured, killed. You had heard about Hate Church, and it grabbed every bit of your imagination. You don't know where it is. It is, as far as you know, a sort of mixed club. This is what you've come to find out. It's not kindred are welcome there, but it's mortals who do the boxing. It's also a bit of a feeding haven for the disenfranchised caitiff of the city. They don't feed in the rack for fear of revealing themselves living in the city when they shouldn't be. So Hate Church is buried somewhere in Chicago, probably underneath the streets. The non-Camarilla caitiff that live in the city quietly and try to slip under the radar of the council, they know about it. They've heard of it. You've heard about it from them.
So it'd take a little more digging to uncover its exact location.
Uncovering its exact location is going to be a little more difficult. But do you want to do the investigation yourself, or do you want to send somebody out to just ask some questions?
Arthur will go with, he'll take one of his prize boys and go seek out the track the trail of breadcrumbs. So it's not just him, but it's him with his, he's coming with his prized dog, but then his other prized dog that he's going to be putting into the proverbial ring.
Excellent. Give me how about a wits investigation?
I have some dots in that. Okay.
You're a bit of an investigator, aren't you? You got something there?
That is not a success on the hunger die, but successes on the two others.
So you got two successes. Mm-hmm. I was looking for a little bit more than two. Right. So what you'll find is that you can either burn a little willpower, try to let your beast sniff out something.
Sure, let's do
roll another die or two, depending on how many you have available.
I'll keep the two successes. So I'll just roll.
Yeah, keep the two successes. Roll the other dies.
Come on. Hey, there's another one.
Seven. Got another one?
Yeah.
There is a place in Chicago. They call it the Labyrinth. The Labyrinth isn't just the sewers or the underground subways of Chicago. It's not even the abandoned underground structures that Chicago has. Somewhere in the depths, beneath the subways, beneath the sewers, beneath the oldest remnants of Chicago, is a labyrinth. It's frightening to the kindred. But if you survive in its depths, you'll find a place where the caitiff come together to feed, to dance, to rage, and to fight, and to bet on all of these things. It is actually a church, from what you understand. It is led by a preacher who encourages the caitiff of Chicago to voice their displeasure in everything. They will shout, fuck this, fuck that, fuck the prince, fuck capitalism.
Ah, dear God, they are communists.
You know, they're all kinds of uber liberal, think they can change the world, everything needs to be free, pseudo communists. They wouldn't like that system either if they were under it. But they're just haters. Just general anarchists. Haters. And yes, proper anarchists. Because they have no representation on the council. They're not welcome inside the city. They're not considered part of the population of kindred in Chicago. They are the forgotten. They are the downtrodden. And they congregate at Hate Church.
I love it.
Now, getting to Hate Church is going to be difficult. If you have to go through the labyrinth, you yourself would have trouble. A human probably won't make it.
No, because it's one of those things. It's one of those things where it'll probably be like groups of kindred who will go in and leave, like enter and leave together.
Mm. The end of information.
Fair.
There's no more there.
That's so tempting.
Just do it.
Because werewolf brain is going like, get him, but I don't regenerate by breathing. Because I don't breathe. So there, I get this at the very least. This is wonderful information.
Yes, vampires rouse to heal themselves, and they don't heal themselves all at once. It comes over time.
Yeah.
So just not that you're injured or planning on being injured.
Yeah, but there's probably fucking bouncing Bettys in there that are just full of suck. I have a location. I will wait. And see if I can't get some like-minded kindred to go in there with me. Perhaps for later time.
Ah, man, give that information to Flyboy. Let them take care of it. Kidding.
That could actually be really funny. Go. Send in first light. Let's see what happens.
And then we bet on the council side to see who wins on that one.
Yep. Dusty black coat and a red right hand. Alrighty. I think with that, I'm going to, at the very least, leave my fighters to manage their first tier of
the first level of the tournament you were setting up.
Yes, the preliminaries, weed out those who really shouldn't be here.
You did open it up, so you're going to get some people from around the city. You're going to judge some new talent.
Mm-hmm.
But then, unfortunately, the music kicks on. The montage music.
Just because I took it doesn't mean I have to use it. If anything, I'm going to be saving that for when Hate Church is their champion, and then that'll be their whole kind of like wrestling intro song. I'll just play that for them.
Ooh, that should get the blood boiling.
Stick them. And we'll see what happens.
There's probably a digital style jukebox where you could maybe upload the song and just, bury it somewhere and see if anybody clicks it on during training.
Just a totally unrelated question. If, for example, that digital system, if one were to use dupe on it, which gains a positive response from electronic devices,
yes,
would one, for instance, be able to program it to only play one song regardless of what influence
note to self, have key combination for what's the name of his band? Or
Baby Chorus.
For Baby Chorus connects to C4 inside jukebox.
If anybody plays it, it blows the place up.
Okay. I was just checking hypothetically. Like, let's not pay attention to it.
Purely hypothetical, of course.
I think with an extraordinarily good roll, that probably happens.
Wow. Interesting. That's all. Forgive my interruption. Please
no,
proceed.
No, that was an excellent question.
Love you.
Love you too.
Not even using the mug anymore.
I think that does it for me.
So Arthur has found himself a little side project. Julian, you've got some information from Fiorenza that's shocking to you. Sister, you now know that Kay Marshall's phones, you should have that information as well, are going to be done fairly shortly, and they have extraordinary capabilities.
I'm looking forward to it, and I'm giggling at the fact that I know the first thing that Julian's going to do, even though he probably won't admit it, is take a bunch of selfies.
Yes. Yes. I've waited my whole life.
And so long.
My whole unlife to take a selfie.
I haven't asked you this question, but do you watch yourself? Do you watch the replays of the Pulse of Demundo? Some people don't find it comfortable to watch themselves again.
So I will say that Julian probably has never, but not because he doesn't want to, but because he's afraid that if he does, he knows that he's seen how Lissandra can get obsessed with seeing themselves, which is why he hasn't tried. But the V phone is a very dangerous temptation for him. So once he gets that, he probably will, and it'll be a whole thing.
I look forward to this. Excellent.
One thing did hop to mind.
Hmm?
If Rosa is available for
further
vis-a-vis.
Go for Rosa, it, buddy.
She would love to talk to you. What do you want to say to her?
So, touch base on the recent developments, perhaps. Bounce some ideas off of her, see if I am merely paranoid.
Who do you want to talk about, or what do you want to talk about?
First, see if there's other gangrel around our level who would like to get a cut on the hate church business.
Oh, you've heard of hate church now, huh? You're going to chase that rumor.
The rumor is, it led me with this little bit of golden fleece to an actual labyrinth. Which is why I would love to have some like-minded individuals to go in. And I'm looking on enterprising with my creme de la creme. Having my prize fighters get some oomph from my end. And of course, if you have some herd of yours who would like to go through similar crucible.
I'm very surprised that it's just a business deal for you. I figured you would want to find Hate Church for different reasons.
Well, there's one that can only plan so much before you see the thing with your own eyes. I've been disappointed by myth and fable before.
You know that it's the clanless, the ones who don't ascribe to clans, the ones that were embraced without regard. That is who's down there.
And sometimes the dispossessed, they hear things, and then if one of those things slips into my ear, and then I get a little blood drunk, and I forget to seal my mouth, and the information I learn comes to you.
If you want to go, you can go, but
What do the caitiff have for you? Nothing.
That is primarily why I think they do. The greatest gift you can give someone is to underestimate them. Which comes to my paranoia.
You have a paranoia? I hadn't noticed.
Nice. It's, with all of the drama unfolding in the recent nights. I could not help but observe that with all the terrible things happening with the La Sombra, the one I know is not present in their dealings. Always made himself scarce whenever they were around. Perhaps he is afraid of them. Perhaps he no longer likes that he is not the only kid in town.
I do not know, but he is not the same kind of La Sombra. You know what I mean?
People do not change.
He's not Sabbat. You know, there's many things you could say about Julian White, but he is not Sabbat. I don't know how Camarilla he is, but
Montano. I believe Julian is simply Julian.
Hey, he is simply Julian. He is sort of like a caitiff himself. Alone. Clanless. A singular Montano.
That's what they said. The Lupins always say the strength of the pack is the wolf. Always fear the lone wolf. I would like you to, if he's not too bold, keep tabs on him.
Oh, shall we?
It would be a great favor to me. I do not have his level of resource or influence, but what I do have is a genius woman who's high up in the chain of command.
Oh. You flatter me.
No, but if I have ever learned one thing about the chain of command, it's when you need to, you grab that chain and you beat someone with it.
See, you are correct. All right. Requests go up the chain, orders come down the chain. This request I will do for you, but you will take an order from me later for it.
I am yours to command. It's like with the Russian.
Malenkov?
Malenkov. He kept trying to get under my skin, calling me dog, but he forgets. All the great kings and queens did their best hunting with hounds at their side. So I am your hound.
I love your devotion. You're truly good for us. For the gang.
I am nothing but a patriot.
So you know, pass this along. Malenkov, he's starting to be heard around town. He's going to places, scaring people, flashing his fangs. It's only time before he starts leaving stains on the street.
He is breaking the veil in my suit. It's very bad. Is there a certain place he has been frequenting, or has he just been all over?
He's been popping into strip clubs and bars, the low life places.
Oh, on the Monday, just gave me an idea.
Oh, you let your ideas go. You work them out. Rosie is going to take her leave because that's all the information she was going to provide to you. Malenkov is just, he's been spotted around the city. Yep. So he hasn't left. He hasn't done anything truly dangerous yet, but he has breached the masquerade a couple of times by flashing his fangs to mortals who freaked out.
It's just been randomly, not in like centered in one particular spot.
A bondage club here, a strip club there, a dive bar somewhere else.
He's just out having a good time.
He is.
Okay. They don't expect us to gather him up. He's a scary individual.
Yeah, no, he hasn't done anything so far that would require attention like that. But yeah.
All right. He's so note to self. Let's see if we can get him to hear about church.
Oh.
Set to a hog like him, that's a really juicy truffle.
I love the idea. Think of a way to get that message to him. Something clever that would possibly work.
Mm-hmm.
And also consider the consequences of leading Malenkov to an army.
If I'm on the winning side, who cares, huh?
The disenfranchised caitiff of the city are numerous. You've never seen them all in one place. You've never seen a collection of them, but you can imagine.
I can imagine that he'd end up getting an army.
But if nothing else, the labyrinth deals with him.
Let him do it. Let him do it because he still hasn't fulfilled Rose's request. Mm-hmm. She gave him an order and he still hasn't done that yet. So he just let him keep cashing in checks. I can't wait.
Oh my God, you guys are killing me. Okay, you know what? Go ahead. Let's just
say I love Arthur.
I'm done. We're good.
I love Arthur. He's my favorite.
Oh, so many of these games, when you watch them on the internet, are full of coteries that have respect and admiration.
We were doing so good. You know what it was? It's because Lilith freaking left, man.
Was she holding you all together?
Yeah.
She was the grease that kept the gears from grinding.
She was the baby.
That's when it all went wrong.
She will be happy to hear that.
So I had nothing else to do other than that.
Sister, I will put you in touch with Dusable if you want to talk to him.
No, I'll wait till next time. It's cool. We're good. I am too stressed right now to be able to handle Dusable the way he needs to be handled.
Well, then talk to me about this. What are your plans for what you would like him to do?
Dusable to do?
Yeah. What is your ideal outcome for Dusable? He's not going to let it go.
Oh, I know he's not going to let it go, but I do want him to pursue, just not taking complete control of K. Marshall Ellis, that understand that we do have a really good setup for him right now. He's in a good environment. He's coming up with all these things. He's teaching us a couple of little things here and there. Oh, you should really talk to him so you can learn a couple more things. I won't tell him what, just like we're learning new things and it's amazing. And then talk mostly about the phone and then give a little bit about the powers. Because I know he's going to find out. I'd rather not lie to him. But I also don't want him to take it all away because I want to learn it too.
And if so, you're gonna bring him in? You're going to allow him to?
Yeah, since Julian said we could set up a dummy lab, not like the lab, just in case Dusable decides to rage out.
Oh, no. I said if he wants to see Dusable, he's not coming back. But he's also not coming to the lab. If he wants to meet with Dusable, you're kind of right. We will meet at a second location. Mm-hmm. Dusable's not coming to my lab.
Oh yeah, I know that.
But if he wants to meet at the dummy location, then he's taking K. Marshall with him.
So I actually need to convince you not to let that happen, or no, you know what? I'm just gonna let them talk it out. We're all gonna meet together and I'm just gonna sit there. this is too much for my brain right now. But
good
either
luck
way,
with that one.
Yeah, I know. Especially with how everything's going right now, right? But no,
Julian's fine now.
No.
Do you want to set up said meeting? You, Dusable, K. Marshall Ellis, and Julian.
I would like to talk it all out. Yes.
In a
we don't know.
Neutral location.
Yes.
Julian, how do you feel about that?
There's a stray Malkavian running around who we don't know where he is. I really don't feel comfortable.
Well, stray, I mean, neutral location can still be a secure location.
If you can guarantee that, absolutely.
Oh, son of a bitch. Unfortunately, I know I don't have the resources to promise a secure enough location that would work for you. Do you have a secure enough location?
The securest location I know of right now is the lab that he's at.
And sister, I should mention, your haven is perfectly secure. It's not neutral ground because it belongs to you.
Right.
But
would that bother Julian if it's not considered like true neutral?
Oh, I trust
you. As long as it's secure. Okay, then we can go there because everyone knows where that is. And
well, you guys can take him. There's no need for me to be there.
Are you sure?
I'm sure. Whatever you decide to do with him, it's fine. But once he leaves my lab, he's not coming back to it. For the same reasons. We don't know who might be watching.
All right. So before I set up this meeting, I will disseminate that part of the information to Disable. That we're going to lose out on this good lab. And unless Disable has something better, then Marshall Ellis might not be able to create his creations.
For safety reasons, of course.
I'll pass it along and try to keep the sarcasm out of my voice.
Please do.
So the meeting can happen. Julian will not attend.
I mean, if she needs me to,
And if Kay Marshall does attend.
He can't go back.
He can't go back and continue his work.
Yeah, because that will blow his dead cover. He'll be seen again, especially coming back to the convent. He'll be seen alive again because we didn't change his face. So I'm going to explain all of that to Disable with the possible, you could probably make him work on your own, but we're getting some really good stuff. Do I have to roll? I can feel he's going to ask me to roll or something.
I'm just going to say that there's a level of obstacles that Disable is not very comfortable with at this point. He's not being allowed to see K. Marshall Ellis without severe repercussions. Well, no, let's be frank. If he sees K. Marshall Ellis and takes K. Marshall Ellis, that's it for the V-phone. That's it for the blood technology.
From with his ability.
With Julian's
his
resources.
Lab, with his resources. But I'm sure Disable has resources as well.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's the thing. I don't know if Dusable's resources, if he's been up with the technology, if he's at cutting edge the way Julian is. So I'm the one stuck in the middle. I'm in a convent with a hospital. That's as technologically advanced as I got right now, okay? So I don't have the resources to use K. Marshall Ellis to hit his best ability. And that's unfortunately the terms that, Julian's having with us right now. I'm just the unfortunately middle broker right now.
I am going to have you roll. you need to convince somebody here. What does your sheet look like here?
Form manipulation, 3 in composure. I don't know.
How about manipulation persuasion?
Okay, where's my persuasion? There it is.
Because I could see you've got plenty of that.
Come on, we want those fee phones.
Well, if you weren't such a duh.
I'm trying to help you. You said that you don't want him to have it. Ooh.
What did you roll here? Oh, my.
Whoa.
4, 9, 2 10s, an 8, and an 8.
Tens are worth 2, right?
Tens are worth 2. So that's 7, 8. You got an. I'm not even going to roll against you because he hasn't got enough dice.
My heart.
he doesn't. He doesn't have enough dice in wits awareness or anything to actually fight this persuasion off. You have a golden tongue today, sister. You weave words like silk. They penetrate his mind. They make sense to him. He's reconsidering his entire thing. He asks you only one thing then. He wants what DuSable creates, or what K. Marshall creates. DuSable wants what K. Marshall creates.
Okay.
If there's a phone, he gets a phone. If there's a power, he gets power. If there's a discipline, he gets discipline.
Okay.
That is the best he will do, and he will trust you on the rest.
It's only fair, because then these powers will be learned at some point anyway, and as long as we get to learn them first, we can learn how to combat them too. I'm not going to tell him that, but that's the way my thought process goes.
You already rolled the 7. Stop trying to buy it back. You've already sold the farm. You don't need to buy it back. Yeah, an incredible roll will allow you to convince him of something he was not going to be otherwise convinced of. So, excellent work, sister.
Oh, my God. I'm done.
Yeah. Hang up. It's like that scene in Moneyball. When you get the answer you want, you just hang up the phone.
Hang up. Okay, thanks. Bye.
Without Lilith for the rest of this, it's going to be a little bit difficult. But since your individual things are all either irons in the fire or have been rectified or resolved, what are you going to do as a coterie? How are you going to get together? What are your plans? And I will try to involve Lilith in those plans through what she's going to.
I want to get that symbol painted on the thing, lure out this coterie, get them killed off, find the other Lysandra, and complete the one mission we got from the prince, which was bring them to a meeting and check on the other chick to make sure she's healed up. That's my plan.
Yeah, we can't put the symbol on because we are not ready to ambush them on their way out.
Yes, you don't actually have a place.
Yeah.
And you could use that safety symbol, if it's not already obvious, to take them someplace. You know, you put the symbol here, it's safe to leave. You put the symbol here, follow this. You put the symbol here, there's your ambush point, or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah, but it's still within Sun's territory.
That doesn't matter as long as it doesn't happen in the open cemetery. The prince has purview.
Yeah, okay. So the prince gave us permission to be in Sun's territory.
You have permission to kill this coterie anyway, except in the open cemetery, because that has to be a no-kill zone for all of Kindred.
Then Julian has an idea. It's just going to cost a little bit of money to do. Well,
what's money to Julian?
Well, I say we lead them to a building and drop a fucking cage down on it and let the sun greet them.
How does everybody else feel about that?
Been a long time since I had the barbecue.
If it works, I mean, it'll get our job done.
Yeah, who knows? We might catch more than one. But even if we just catch one.
Well, that was what Damien had told you. If you catch one, the rest of the coterie is likely to try to come after him and rescue him. Or her, depending. Malord is a woman.
Mm-hmm. It's up to you guys.
It's a solid enough plan, but there's plans are always the first casualty of any operation. But we have some backups just in case.
Well, that's why you're here.
Of course. I have a contingency in my trunk.
Which is?
Does the crafting difficulty to make something, you know, a certain Russian cocktail.
You want a Molotov?
Yeah.
Those things are easy to make. Yeah. You got a bathtub and some gas and some booze. And
I think he's thinking about one that can really, really affect a vampire, though, yeah?
Like, perhaps...
fire is fire.
Yeah. It was like it's just like the crafting difficulty because, you know, God forbid a botch and I immolate myself and I do my best Burning Man impersonation.
Is it possible to craft like a Molotov that'll like stick the way napalm does?
It requires a lot of axle grease and a tube sock.
Or a sprinkler system.
That's, you'd have to replace the water with whatever other substance you would like, but that could happen too.
Home defense, I like it.
I mean, if we're not planning on being inside the building, then maybe we don't need the cage, or maybe we use it, and when the rest come to rescue, whoever we catch...
We have it on the outside to go off.
Pool party.
Criminal contact to get a rocket launcher. Just throwing that out there.
Anything is possible.
Sniper with gangrel tip rounds.
You've already got some. You don't have to do that to yourself.
Got to get a sharpshooter, though.
Because we want something that'll just make it like as many of them vanish as possible.
Julian is thinking big. He is thinking, if I'm reading this right, purchasing an abandoned building or warehouse or something, a place to lure them to that would be under your complete control and has been modified in ways to be lethal.
Yeah.
Would that be possible, not with knowing that we might be being watched?
Do you feel like you're being watched?
I always feel like I'm being watched.
That's, I wasn't asking Julie. That's, or even Arthur for that matter. But
they've made me paranoid.
Good. Hey, welcome to the name of the game.
We've been followed. We've been shot at. I'm like, seriously? Shot at?
You have. You've been attacked by some biggies.
So
and by some small fry, which is odd.
So yes, I'm a little paranoid right now.
All right. You can each roll me a wits awareness roll, but I tell you this, for the past couple of episodes, you have rolled wits awareness rolls to notice this, and nobody's noticed it yet.
It doesn't help that I have nothing in awareness.
Oh, that was a fault of...
my decision's there.
It's not. It could only get better a few ways, but that's three successes.
Three successes, okay. Yep.
One on one success on each die. So close to a 10.
It's got two.
Bastard.
Oh, nope.
And
I'm surprised.
Ooh,
did you get anything?
Just remember, if we find the person who's watching us, we charge them because it's $5 a minute. Two,
six successes.
Well, four. Oh, yeah, 5, 6. Okay, you got the one from up there. Julian. You think you are being watched from a great distance by a female Nosferatu who seems to obfuscate herself whenever your vision almost locks onto her.
Can you define by a very far distance?
For a vampire, it is, 500 yards, say. With heightened senses, with auspex, with the ability to obfuscate herself, she can keep an eye on you from a pretty damn good distance. And you only catch her out of the corner of your eye. Like I said, if you look directly at her, she's gone. But you're pretty sure she was over there? No, gone.
Okay. Well, all of my paranoia has been very well founded then.
And by the way, the threshold for that was 5, which is why you've never seen her before.
Okay. I don't, I mean, I obviously can't catch that hoe, so I don't know. What do I know about Nosferatu's ability to spy?
They are the sneakiest sons of bitches on the planet. When, even when you met Calhoun, you'll remember that he was at a typewriter and simply activating his excellent hearing and listening to conversations from across the room. That's how he gets all his scoops, is just unobtrusively spying on people in full view of the public.
Okay.
He also has a bit of a NOS network. Information travels. You've got yourself a NOS symbol, and you can bet where there's one, there's more.
But there's also that one lady.
Edith Bobien, who has the painted lady, which you have a tattoo for. She is a hideously deformed NOS.
Well, then we have to do something about this Nosferatu. Is what I'm thinking silently. I'm going to say, everybody, would you like to... We need to take a load off. Let's go to the club.
The Painted Lady Club, or which club are you talking about?
That's the one.
That's the one? I'm so excited for you to go to the Painted Lady. Does everybody want to meet there?
Sure. We got the tattoos. Might as well use them, right?
Yeah. Didn't get the ink for no reason.
Near South Side, just off of the 55, very near Chinatown, but not in Chinatown, there is a place called the Painted Lady.
Oh, wait, we can't go here without Lilith.
Now? Okay, why not?
I mean, we're gonna, but I'm just saying, because this is like her, this is where she, you know, can show up and really, really dress the part and, you know, be that person.
Maybe this is where she got to look for astounding, like, accurate.
Maybe we'll run into her here going, this is where you've been, you naughty girl. Yeah. Okay, that's fine. Continue.
Yeah.
We will perhaps use the Painted Lady then as a meeting point for all of you. But let me get you there.
Ooh, pretty. Wow.
I do like this picture. Now... Yes. Don't zoom in too much or you'll realize that comes off of a street in Amsterdam or Germany or somewhere, but it is not actually in Chicago. The Painted Lady, though, that sort of neon legs wrapping around, that is the symbol of the Painted Lady. And and Edith Bobien. Don't believe, let me see. I don't think you've met her yet, have you?
No.
Well, let me find you a picture. There we go. Inside the Painted Lady, which you will get into from your tattoos.
Wow.
Actually, that's not the one. This one's a better picture. There we go. The hideously deformed NOS of Edith Bobien. Gigantic ears, hair completely gone, the forehead swelling up with veins running down her side of her face. The nose is gone. The eyelids, eyes are completely recessed as the brow kind of hunches over. She's hideous to look at, but wonderfully charming. Oh, dears, welcome to the Painted Lady.
It's a pleasure to be invited. What an establishment.
Oh, are you here for a bit of the slap and tickle?
She's a new favorite. I love it. Okay.
just more to check it out. I've heard such good things about this place.
Oh, dear. Show me your tattoo.
So, yeah.
If you do, she will run her bony, elongated finger over the tattoo. And she'll be like, oh, Roy boy.
Madame, is that a tickle you warned me about?
I miss Roy boy. He does
very highly of you.
Oh, he does such good work. Look at it. Ah, welcome then. I don't know you, but I am Edith Beaubien. I'm the purveyor of this establishment. We have what you like. A bit of the struggle, a bit of the fight, a bit of the smack smack, and a bit of the feeding if you feel so hungry.
She's precious. I'm keeping her.
This is great. Julian, and I will take her hand and I will kiss her hand.
No, it's, you could practically see through it at the top of the palm. The skin is thin and gray and almost translucent.
Yep.
She loves you. Well,
Hi, Arthur.
How may I help?
Actually, are there any specific rules of the establishment? You know, rules are very important.
Rules. Just say your desires and they shall happen.
Ooh, it's that type of club. Okay.
We need a private place to talk with you if it wouldn't be too much trouble.
Oh, moi.
You're out of discerning taste and you're obviously the best vintage on the menu.
Oh. She just says, follow me, and take you down a hall. She'll take you back to her private office where you can have a conversation. Edith lights up a long, thin cigarino. She doesn't actually smoke it, but she lets it burn and puts it in her mouth and keeps taking it away.
Mm. Oh, that bits always do die hard.
True.
We have a small issue, and we are in the process of taking care of it. Unfortunately, a rather troublesome Malkavian from out of town is doing a little bit of snooping. Nosferatu is doing a little bit of snooping.
It is what we do.
Yes. Which is why we were hoping that you could give us some insight into how best to work around her particular method.
Oh, I see.
For the prince.
Of course. I wouldn't presume otherwise. Oh, how to capture a Nos. She puts it in her mouth, doesn't actually take a drag, then taps it out a little bit. Well, you've got to be able to find them first. If you see them, you've already gotten the first step. They're slippery, but they're not good fighters. Oh, except for me, of course.
Of course.
I put up a bit of a scratch if you come after me. So, if you see them first, you have the advantage. And if you get close enough, just grab them. They have no ability to fight away. Everything in between, they are so hard. They can run.
Seems like a bit of struggle.
They can hide.
So, I'm unfamiliar with this particular set of gifts. that your clan employs. Obfuscate, is it blinds the viewer, all of the viewer's senses, merely the sight, or could one, just to Napoleon, perhaps track a scent?
She does something amazing for you. She puts her little long cigarino down. Sitting in her chair behind her desk, she's like, pay attention. And she's gone. She has literally vanished right in front of your eyes. You could see through the spot she was sitting in. You could see the chair. You can even see the chair move a little. And you could hear her say, boo. But you can't see her.
Napoleon, can you hear or smell where she is?
Napoleon is blinded to whatever she is doing. He can't see her for sure, but he can smell the death. He can smell the desiccation of the corpse.
Where is she, boy?
Napoleon will kind of go around to the other side of the desk and brum, just right up onto the chair. And you can see that somebody is now like petting his head. But you can't see the hand that's doing it.
Be careful, he likes to kiss faces without permission. It's a poor trick he picked up from me.
And he'll do just that.
As a good boy.
And you see from an invisible spot on the chair, just sort of hovering there, a little bit of the dribble from his big wet kiss just goes drip, as if it was just hovering in the midair.
That is stunning, madame. You are a master.
And whoosh, she'll reappear again and wipe her cheek. So she has shown you the level of vanishing ability that a Nosferatu has. They don't just kind of fade into the shadows. They don't go away, become translucent and sort of fade. They just click out of existence.
But they will at least leave behind us their scent.
A scent that they cannot hide. Now, she will tell you that there are some who can do other things. There are some who can hide their sounds completely, as well as their image. So even if she had said boo, you wouldn't have been able to hear her. If she had gotten up off the chair and walked across the top of the desk, you wouldn't have heard a thing.
That's she tells a you, voyeur skill.
Yes, she tells you this is what the Nos do. They're fast. They are sneaky. They can hide themselves. But they are not fighters.
Well, we already know that one was following me, so I will...
Spotted her.
Yes.
Ooh, lucky you.
What can I say? I'm popular. So perhaps the two of you could intercept my surveillance?
Edith will suggest something. You've mentioned, I think, by now that you have a symbol that you know, a Nos symbol. Mm-hmm. There are more. There are other symbols, often mistaken as simple graffiti, that you can either read them or write them, leave information or glean information. What would you like to know? What symbol would you like to be able to find or plant? Safe is one thing. But...
It's just like, I guess for like a D&D equivalent, kind of like Thieves' Cant?
Yeah, think of it like that. Think of simple instructions that can be, or information that can be planted in a single image.
blind spot, like a blind spot in surveillance.
How do you mean? Like leading somebody to a place where you're
not... like a place where they wouldn't necessarily need to use their powers, or like a place where they wouldn't be caught on surveillance cameras. I don't know if Nos are caught on surveillance cameras.
Nos are. They don't suffer that same bane as you, but usually they just hide themselves or completely go invisible because of their hideous features. But if you're talking about putting out a symbol that says that you have no reason to hide your hideous features, something like that.
Like feeding?
Yeah. Like this is a feeding area. This is an Elysium area. This belongs to whatever. There's many different symbols. Choose and just consider them one or two word descriptors. And she can show you what they are and allow you to either use them or read them if you find them.
Do we have to choose now, or can we think about this for a bit?
Why don't you guys think about this for a bit?
Because I'm like, I don't want to rush this. This is important.
Let's hold this meeting here. It is now 1 o'clock Pacific time. It's not exactly the right place to end it, but if I do it right, we should be able to bring Lilith in right at this point in 2 weeks. We're off next week for our kind of mid-season break, and then we're back for 6 straight episodes to bring us into the end of the story. We'll have Grace back by then, and we'll fill her in on what you guys have been doing. And when she comes back, she can maybe fill you in on what she has been up to. So thank you, everybody, for joining us for Windy City Kindred. Grace isn't here, but we'll, for fuck's sake, Grace, we'll say hi to her as Lilith. And then let's go down the cast list. Malenre, tell us about yourself.
You're still mad about the cats, aren't you?
I love the cats.
Yeah, huh? I'm Malenre, and I was, you know, just playing Sister today more Calypso today than Sister because I didn't actually put on more the habit. Calypso,
yeah.
Yeah, more Calypso. So she's... Actually, she as a character and me as player, I'm very stressed out because of these other two that I'm stuck with. Lilith, Grace, come back, please.
Wow. Yes. Yes. Wow. Julian White, you are actually Wesley Anderson in life.
That's me. Yeah, I played Julian White, having a lot of fun.
Having a lot of fun or having a lot of fun?
Both with and without the quotes.
You just, oh, so many other shows. The coterie gets along. They work towards a united goal. You guys create more drama than Onyx Path wrote into the book.
We get along nominally. We do. But we have our own things.
You do. And it's...
I actually think that this is bringing Arthur and Julian closer.
Yeah, it's
that's
it's
just smart.
It's the tectonic plates are, you know, causing a lot of tension, and right before they're
rubbing meet, against each other.
Yeah, they're trying to find that. You know, then hey, look, all that tension creates Everest, and you know we're the biggest, best thing in the entire city. It'll be fine. It'll be great.
Throwing a shout out there. Check out Wes's show on Monday nights. Savannah.
Under Shadows.
I keep wanting to say Savannah by Sunset, but Savannah Under Shadows. I dig it. I really enjoy it. And together we do a lot of different role-playing stuff. You can catch the superhero show, Saturday Morning Superheroes, right before us on Saturdays. You can catch the Down Roll and the Greyhawk shows that we do on Wicked Studios. Wicked Studios and Tales from the Savage Land, which is my show with Grace and Malenre in the chat on Wednesday night. So we got a lot of great entertainment if anybody ever notices and starts watching us. Alex, you've been our gang girl for tonight.
Yep.
Our bully boy
Saturday.
It's a good old time. I love it.
But boy, I can't wait for you to find Hate Church.
Yeah, let's not do that, because right when he said there was a priest there, I'm just like, don't. Just don't.
What Arthur's going to go in there is just be like, I belong here. And then just.
And we never saw him again.
Yep.
It's like he's either dead or he's just become, you know, an actual underground type.
He's dead or in charge. That's yes. The two things. It'd be like the man who would be king.
Yes. No, but it's great. The Frenchman finding the Chicago's Court of Miracles. I dig it.
I like it.
Yeah, let's go hang out with some Romani type vampires. All the dispossessed be great.
And you also play video games online. Tell people where to find you.
Yes, it's anywhere video games can be played, whether it's PlayStation, PC. You can find me under the handle StormWolf92. Forewarned, I am not that good at them, so at the very least you can laugh at me. So you'll have a grand old time either kicking my ass or laughing as I stumble through everything else. Either way, that's fine.
Yeah, I'm just working out on Fortnite Chapter 2, so if anybody wants to come kick Tony Lasagna's ass, you find me there.
I love that name.
Tony Lasagna. I've had my Xbox handle for a long time, man. So having a name, like it's Tony Lasagna, there's a space in the middle, there's no numbers, there's no underscores, it's old school Xbox.
OG.
Yeah, OG. That's me, baby. Well, everybody, thank you for joining us. Thank you to Wicked Studios and our producer Will DM for DMing, but being our general manager this time around. And with that, let's have Will take me back to the regular screen, and then I think that's it. This is technically episode 6. There was 6A. This is 6B. We're going to stitch them all together by the time it appears up on YouTube. So this is all going to be one big episode, and hopefully it'll all come together just right, and it'll look good and sound good. Otherwise, who knows? But join us again in 2 weeks. We'll have Grace back. We'll have the full coterie back, and we're going to get into some shit, I promise you. And with that, let's have my Will turn off the Twitch stream.
Bye.
Bye.